So we have over to Dr. Sanjay Rao sir for the next session. Dr. Sanjay Rao sir, will you start the discussion? Dr. Sanjay Rao sir, I think is off.
Hello, this is Dr. Shrotriya.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, yeah. Sir, we can hear you.
Yeah, so the concept was that first Dr. Vikram Raut will speak, then I will speak, and then Sanjay will speak, and lastly we will discuss.
Okay, sir. So Dr. Vikram Rao, we have made you the co-host. You can share your screen now.
Yeah, good afternoon. Thanks for giving me this opportunity. So as we discussed, we will divide this session into three parts. I will talk about a history, indication, and preoperative assessment of liver transplant. So and then Dr. Shrotri sir will talk about surgical aspect, and Dr. Rao will talk about the long-term outcome of liver transplant. So I will begin with my talk. So the in terms of history of liver transplant, it goes back to the certain discoveries happen in the surgical field, and mainly it is to the attributed to the Alex Carrel in first century of 1st decade of 19th century, where he has discovered about the anastomosis of blood vessels. He also discovered about the cold storage of blood vessels, and he showed if you preserve the blood vessels in a cold storage, you can reuse them. And also he popularized the concept of whole organ transplantation in 1908. And because of this discovery, he was given a Nobel Prize in 1912. After this initial research, the various transplantations of experiments were done both in the animals and in the humans. But from the first decade of 19th century to the first actual transplant, kidney transplant, that performed by Professor Joseph Murray in USA, that happened in 1952. So there was various challenges during this period. People have understood that there are challenges in terms of surgical technique, there are challenges in terms of immunosuppression. The rejection of organs was well known by that time, and that's the reason why the first successful kidney transplant was done from the identical twins in 1954. With this background, the many experiments were also started in terms of liver transplant. So Vittorio from the Milan, he initially tried the transplantation in the animal models. The Welch devised the technique, and he showed just like a kidney transplant, the heterotrophic transplant of the liver can be done, and he actually transplanted the hepatic graft in the right paravertebral girdles in the dogs. But in 1956, the Jack Cannon, he mentioned the technique of orthotopic transplantation, where the old liver was replaced and that new liver is put in a place of new liver. And this is a usual technique which is still a standard of technique. Thomas Tarzel was considered as the father for transplantation, or he has immensely contributed in liver transplantation. So in about 1960, he was posted in Miami as a resident, and during his residency, he used to get a lot of the gunshot injuries because there's a lot of crime in the Miami. And he has done a lot of hands-on training in terms of repairing those vessels, anastomosing those vessels. And from this, he took it to his experiment in the dogs, and he almost published the experience of 80 canine liver transplant in 1960. Professor Starzl in 1963 initially reported the first three transplants in 1963. The first transplant was again a child who died on a table due to bleeding, due to coagulopathy, hypothermia. After that, almost for 6-7 years, he stopped doing transplant. And in 1967, the first successful transplant was
Dr. Raut. I think we've lost Dr. Vikram Raut for a while.
Call him up.
Till the time we contact him, sir, can you or Dr. Sanjay Rao, sir, make your presentation, sir?
That would not be correct.
Yeah, Vikram, are you there?
Yeah. The first transplant in 1960.
Vikram, we can't see your screen.
19. Okay, Vikram. So first successful transplant was reported on the 19-year-old girl with hepatocellular carcinoma, and this transplant was successful. This girl lived for almost a year after transplant, and then she died due to metastasis. Similarly, in other part of the world, Roy Khan from UK and Henry Bismuth, during a similar period, tried the technique of transplantation, and then this became a standard of care in 1980s. In terms of development of transplant for children, it came from the various breakthroughs. In 1984, Henry Bismuth from Paris, he reported a split transplant, and where the left lobe was used for a transplantation in a children. Taking a cue from this disease donation, Raza from Brazil. So initially, this was first attempt in 1989 to do the pediatric transplant from the living donor, and in this case, the father was a donor. But successful pediatric LDLT was reported from Australia by Strong et al. In 1983, at Kyoto, when they're doing living donor liver transplant, they also use
Dr. Raut. Dr. Raut?
I think you should call him.
We are calling him. He's not picking up.
Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, Vikram?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can hear you. We can't see your screen. I think your internet connection is an issue. So I would suggest you switch off your video and just continue with the audio.
Yeah. Fine. Okay. So at the same time, the development of this surgical technique, there's a lot of discoveries happen on organ preservation and also on immunosuppression front. Initially, Professor Starzl used the cold solution to the portal vein, and that was a technique used for almost 10 to 15 years until the Belzer from University of Wisconsin proposed the University of Wisconsin solution. and which is a standard of care so far. Similar discoveries were reported in the development of immunosuppression. So before, at the time of 1960s, people were aware that the rejections are common, and the standard of care was the steroids and azathioprine. Professor Rang can first use the cyclosporine in a patient with a kidney transplant in about 1980s, and then Professor Thomas Starzl reported use of tacrolimus in 1989. And from there, the success of transplant, which was about 50% survival, it went to almost 80 and 90%. And over the last 30 years, the success of transplant is almost stable, because by and large, the technique of the surgical technique and immunosuppression is standardized.
Again, we have lost Dr.
Can I ask him to go in some other room?
Yeah, I just spoke to him. He's having some network issues. So could I please request Dr. Sanjay Rao sir or Dr. Shrotir to...
I can start my...
Sir, yes, you can please start your presentation till that time. Vikram has network issues.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
So, you want me to share the screen now?
Yes, sir, please.
Can you see my screen now?
Yes, sir, we can see your screen.
Yeah, I am Dr. Shrotri. I am pediatric surgeon in KM Hospital, Pune. So I am going to now give a talk on surgery on for liver transplant. To start with, we can see that there are two kinds of liver transplant that is done. One is called DDLT and one is called LDLT. DDLT means diseased donor, and LDLT is live donor. So what happens is, who is disease donor? It is a cadaver, that is when the heart is beating but the brain is dead. So we have two kinds of DDLTs in pediatric liver transplant. One is that there can be a pediatric cadaver, which is a very small baby whose liver can be generated. But in our country, hardly there has been incidences where we have a pediatric cadaver. There are exceptions, however, it is mostly a future. Cadaveric split, that is, you take a left part of the cadaveric liver and that you can split and give it one part to the child and one part to the adult. So that is also not in vogue, I would say. So mostly we depend on a live donor. Live donor who is related to the child is what the losses, but unless if there is no related donor, in very, very exceptional circumstances, we can consider a donor who is not related to the child. So the related donor is usually the mother or father. The donor has to be less than 50 years, and actually Vikram would be telling you about all the criteria of who will be the donor and who can, who will not be. We will stick to the surgery part. So the first part about doing surgery is in consent. Now, consent is always a very important thing in pediatric transplants, because pediatric liver transplant, or for that matter any transplant, you are replacing one disease by another. And you need to tell the parents and to the family that it is not some sort of, you know, magic that is going to happen. You have to go, there are going to be issues and there are going to be long-term consequences also. So the it is always audiovisual, the surgeon, the main surgeon, the anesthetist and the coordinator. Now this coordinator fellow, he is a very exceptionally important thing in liver transplanting. So anybody who aspires to, any center who is aspiring to do a liver transplant, for them the coordinator has to be very good. He has to organize everything, talk to the family, deal with lots of issues. In the consent, we need to discuss about donor morbidity, though in a very positive sense. But as far as the recipient morbidity is concerned, you need to tell them that either it is transplant or it is going to be death by chronic or acute liver disease. So apart from that, you need to tell the parents about the economics, the kind of money that is, what is the package, what is the amount of things which are going to be in the package and which are outside the package. They have, there should be absolute crystal clear point of view about both the family and the surgical team also. So once that is done, you need to tell them about the schedules. When we say that it is minus one day, then 0 day and one day, then you need to keep all the schedules. You need to use your manpower. You need to use all the resources in a very, very organized manner. So it is like a big event, and the coordinator is one of the, you know, executives of the event, and the, probably the surgeon or a hepatologist in some circumstances is the event manager here. So next comes the donor surgeon. Now, so you can see this is, hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, Shrotesh, Shashank, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, because there is no...
there is no feedback.
Yeah. So this GRWR, that is the graft versus recipient's weight. So let's say the 10 kilogram child is there. How much liver is enough and how much can fit into his tummy? That is what is determined by this GRWR. That means that for a 10 kilogram baby, it would be 80 grams to 300 grams. If you put more than that part in the baby's tummy, then the blood supply will be not enough. And if you put less than that, less than 80 gram, it would mean that much is not enough for the baby. So once, for this is a very important part of the things, let's say that this may be 80 gram, whereas this may be up to 300 grams. So you need to know what are you going to fit into that. So this is the lateral, second and third, that is lateral left lobectomy, and this is the total left lobectomy. Mostly in children, we do the left side only. So what happens is that we must know the vascular anatomy of the donor. We are talking about the donor now, and the prime most part of liver transplant is the safety of the donor. The safety of the donor means that you have to know how to do a virtual surgery before you actually decide to operate on the person in reality. So here you can see that this is the left lobe of the liver, this is the left hepatic vein, and this is the middle hepatic vein. So we will probably be cutting somewhere here. So we know that we have one vein to drain. Sometimes you may have to tailor make the things. Sometimes you may have to take the middle vein also. So most probably the middle vein is left for the donor, and the remaining liver will be taken for the recipient. Here you can see the portal anatomy. This is a standard portal anomaly, but there are probably, this is the most anomalous region in the body. So this region you need to see before you actually do any surgery. So you can see that this is the left portal. When you are going to cut here, you know the diameter of this, you know all the branches, which whether the left fourth segment is supplied only by this or there are any cross communications. So you need to know all these things beforehand. Now here you can see the hepatic arteries. Today the CT scan can actually tell you almost a complete three-dimensional view of the liver beforehand. So you know the diameter of the thing, you know whether there is any other artery going on this side. So once you know that this is a clean anatomy, you have planned whether there sometimes you can have accessory vessels, all these things, how many arteries, how many vessels you need to take for the recipient, you should know beforehand. So once that is done, then you do what is called as MRCP. Again, here you want to know whether this is the left, this is the right, this is a rotated view, and you know which part of thing is going to be taken, which are the ducts, and how many ducts are going to be there for anastomosis beforehand. Once that is done, then you do what is called as liver volumetry. That is, you know how much volume of the liver you are going to remove. What is the remaining volume, which is drained by the middle hepatic vein, which is drained by the left hepatic vein, and whether what are the cross sections. So you know approximately what kind of, whether you want to reduce this later on, whether you want an additional part of it or something like that. So once that is done, then you are ready for the donor surgery. Then once the day is fixed, everything is fixed, and pre-op evaluation shows that the donor is completely healthy. It means from literally from the toe to hair, everything is examined in the donor. And once that is done and he is taken up, then it is like, it is not the same as doing a hepatectomy that we tend to do, you know, in children for hepatoblastomas or other things, where it is a destructive surgery. This is not a destructive surgery. This is a very seriously done surgery where you should know the anatomy, keeping. You can't cut off these things before we cut the liver, because we want no damage to be done to this part of the liver. So here you can see that this is the porta, this is the hepatic vein, and we are going to dissect it. First part is cholangiography. It is always cholangiography. You must understand that you have done ERCP, but in spite of all that, you should know that this is a very treacherously anomalous part. And you don't want to land up into a bile leak or into some trouble to the donor. So you do a cholangiography, decide where the bile duct is going to come while you are dissecting. Then you start with portal dissection. Now, once the portal dissection is done, you don't ligate anything. First you do parenchymal division properly. After the parenchymal division is done, then the hepatic vein is dissected, and lastly, everything is ligated and the graft is retrieved. Once the graft is retrieved, again, we repeat a cholangiography to see that the donor anatomy is safe. There is no leak, there is no issues in the donor, and there is no hurry in closing the donor. First, we should be dead sure that there is no, there is complete hemostasis, completely you have taken care of bile leaks and everything. Everything is transfixed. It is not a technology bond surgery. It is completely a surgical skill, and absolute perseverance is required for that. So you can see that for donor surgery, this is the kind of, you know, you use PUSA. So every center who aspires to do, they must get used to this thing. There are other instruments also to do these things, but mainly you need to deal with the PUSA part of it. So once that is there, you start doing the parenchymal dissection properly. You can see we are using clips, we are transfixing, and you are using sloops to, you know, take hold of various vessels, everything. Once that is done, and when both the liver is completely well resected, only then you go to the actual vessels and then you ligate them and cut off, and then you keep the stumps. So now let's say that you have done the donor surgery happily, everything has gone smooth, there is no hemorrhage, no mess in the story. Here, the surgeon's skill is not only doing surgery, but his ability to read CT scans properly, MRCPs properly, cholangiographies properly. So there is a genuine learning curve which is involved in this particular scene. And it is not the same as a gastroenterological surgeon or hepatobiliary surgeon simply coming and doing a destructive job. So once that is done, a second part of that, one more comment is on, nowadays we have started to do this split livers. So why, what do you mean by split liver? This is a cadaver. In this is in situ, means the cadaver's heart is beating, the brain is dead, we have opened the abdomen, but before we actually remove the organs, we in situ split it, so that there is no cold ischemia. Because if you remove it and ex vivo try to do that of brain surgery, then there will be some amount of damage. Here you can know where the bleeding is, what is happening. And then once you split it completely, exactly the way you do it in a donor, living donor, then you retrieve the organs so that maximum benefit is given as far as the organ survival is concerned. So it is usually between the child and the adult. This part probably will go to the adult, this part will go to the child. Then comes a story which is normally we don't, as pediatric surgeons, have not encountered much. That is called as bench surgery. Bench surgery is where you wash the organ with custodial solution. Custodial solution is a very cold solution which will clear the thing with all kinds of immune issues and preserve the organ. Once that is done, you start tailoring the things. Means main concept is to make the outflow as large as possible. So once that is done, that outflow has to be done, some amount of, you can use cadaveric vessels as grafts, or you can use grafts which are used basically to increase the amount of outflow that we need. Once that is done, you check for all the portal structures, you try to de-fatten it so as to make it easy for surgery. Now here on one twin OT, one part you are doing the surgery for the donor and you are doing this bench surgery nearby. After that, we are now going to visit what is happening to the pediatric side. So pediatric side, we start when once the donor's liver is seen after laparotomy and we know that, okay, everything is fine and we can go ahead with the child. So the first challenge comes in putting lines, and it is not a small thing. And sometimes you are very happily putting it in 5 minutes, and people who, all the people including me, anybody who boasts that they can very easily put lines, sometimes they really cry tears of blood while putting them. So there are two lines put in one IJV, there are two arteries which are taken, and then the patient has to be covered. This surgery can range from 6 hours to 16 hours and 24 hours also. So this surgery, patient has to be draped in such a meticulous way that the patient's body will not become wet while you are doing such a massive surgery with lot of fluids putting into the abdomen. Then let us see about the anesthesia. There are two distinct aspects of anesthesia: anhepatic, means either with the poor liver or without any liver when you are giving anesthesia, and when you put the graft inside, that time it is post-transplant. So that also will create a different kind of physiological challenge, and the anesthetists have to be exceptionally good for doing a small child. So they are well trained, they are completely peaceful, and you know, there should be no hyperactivity happening on the head side when you are operating. Then there is an issue with coagulation, that is TEG. TEG is what, thromboelastogram, where you take a drop of blood and you know not only whether the coagulation is normal, but which factor, whether it is platelets, whether it is the plasma, whether it is the cryo, what is required, you will come to know with that and you can correct accordingly. Over correction is not necessary. You can be surprised to know that we operate on children whose INRs are more than 4 or whose platelet counts are less than 30 also, 30,000, and yet we do a very massive surgery. So the whole fuss about, you know, platelets are less and he will bleed and INR is 1.5 and all that is not really required. Now, what is Thompson's retractor? Thompson's retractor is an, you know, it is a sort of a retractor which will, which is absolutely essential for this surgery. The comfort of doing surgery is directly proportional to the difficulty of the case. So in circumstances when some things are very easy, it is very easy to, you know, say that, okay, no, I can do without it also. But you must, it is a very expensive thing, cost more than 10 lakh rupees, but this is necessary. Now here you can see that this is a cirrhotic liver. We have opened the abdomen and first thing we are trying to tackle is the IVC. This is the infrahepatic IVC and this is the suprahepatic IVC. Infrahepatic IVC, maybe your heart rate is around 80-85. Here it will go up to 100 plus. Because this is unless you are doing many such surgeries, you will have to get trained meticulously about doing this kind of dissections. This can be, sometimes the liver can wrap around the IVC and it can be quite challenging. There are many, you know, fine intricacies, but we'll come to that now. Then here we are tackling the porta of this cirrhotic liver. You can see this is the CBD, this is the portal vein, this is the left branch, this is the right branch, and you can see this is the left hepatic artery, right hepatic artery, and you can see that it is a very well done, very peacefully done sort of a thing. So portal vein is dissected, and then once now you know that the liver is now ready to be removed, then you can see that this liver is removed. The hepatectomy is done. You can see how many small vessels were entering into the IVC. Each vessel is not only to be clipped, but they are also transfixed with your 60 or 70 proline. So you have to be very meticulous in this part because you don't want any post-operative issues with the patient. You can say that this is a good IVC. And this is the portal vein, which is dissected. This is hepatic arteries, and somewhere here behind is the bile duct. You have to mark the time when you have removed the liver and hepatic time. Then you mark the time when you start doing the implant. So this is called an explant. Now we go to the implant part of the story. Here, this is the implant part of the story. See, you can see that there is a lot of tailoring which may be required. There is a procedure. This is called as triangulation, so that when the liver, you have to understand that you need a three-dimensional anatomical orientation, that how the graft will fill the abdomen and whether by the weight of the draw, the graft, are you going to really compromise the outflow or not. So for that you are now doing this IVC. This is the graft hepatic veins which are tailored. And then this is called as triangulation of the IVC, and then now I'm going to put the graft. Here you can see that we, after doing the IVC, you do portal vein. Why interrupted? Because this child is small, he's going to grow, and we don't want chronic obstruction to the hepatic veins later on. So it is done in an, part of it is done in an interrupted way. Sometimes in the IVC also part of it is done in an interrupted way. So this will lead to revascularization of the graft. The graft will suddenly fill and then it will start looking very nice. If the outflow is not good, you will see that the graft will become rigid. So on table also your clinical judgment matters quite a lot. Here you can see that we have done an arterial, and there were two arteries, so we have done two anastomoses with interrupted, sometimes continuous. You need to have good loops for this. Occasionally some people do it with microscope, but usually in children this can be a challenge. In this child was almost 17-18 kilograms, so we have done bile duct to bile duct anastomosis here. But you can use a Roux-en-Y Y also, especially in biliary atresia. So see, biliary atresia is a post biliary atresia surgery. When post Kasai surgery, it can be a real challenge. So you know about the complications of surgery. So sometimes you tell yourself, okay, why I have done this surgery. In biliary post-Kasai surgery, sometimes you can say that why was I born? it is as difficult as that sometimes. So once now the liver is, now you can see that beautifully filled up liver now. Now you do intra-op Doppler. You want to know the arterial, the portal flow, the outflow. You have to confirm it beforehand. Once you confirm that yes, now the liver has been well perfused, the next thing you do is then there will be, then you close the abdomen. Now closing the abdomen is also not so simple. You see, trace the bowel properly. See that there were no holes, there are no cautery marks, there is nothing wrong anywhere. There is no hemorrhage anywhere. You put a drain here, and that drain is to be doubly ligated, fixed outside, because if it comes out, it can really cause a huge problem later on. This liver is then fixed to the abdominal wall, and so that it should not rotate once it starts growing up. So once that is done, then the next thing is that you close the abdomen. Now let's say that the patient is now wheeled. Some patients will require ventilation post-op, but less the ventilation, the better it is for the patient. Sometimes when the patient is very septic, you may need it, but you have done at least 10 ABGs by now, and you know where and what direction the things are. In our place, we prefer to deventilate or, you know, extubate the patient on table, because that gives a natural peep, and that is probably associated with minimum possible complications post-op. That would be preferable. Drains can be really nightmare. Sometimes drains are just 20-30 ml per hour. Sometimes they really drain so much that you really have to chase, and, you know, there can be completely, you know, the nights and days can really get ruined. Why I'm seeing this input-output chart? Yes, you have a team of people, pediatric intensivists, pediatric this, pediatric that, who are taking care of the patient, but you are the leader. You need to know everything, everything about everything. You need to know what drugs are given, what are the side effects, what problems they can cause, everything you should know. You should know how to read the input-output chart. There is a completely, this part, there is a special, complete, dedicated sort of learning curve for this, and it is not a rocket science, but you need to know that. You can't say that I am a surgeon, I don't care about this. We have to know everything about this. Nutrition, obviously, as early as possible, oral, minimum possible antibiotics without cultures. We don't do anything about giving antibiotics. And immunosuppression, we have already heard Vikram saying about tacrolimus and such things. Yes, I mean, it is every institute will have their own protocols, and I can just summarize this as saying it is like, you know, using the accelerator just enough to immunosuppress it just enough so that you know that the patient's liver is working and things are not going wrong. So this is how the important post-op issues go. Now coming back to the donor is wheeled back. What are the problems? What are the possible problems that come? And sometimes there can be bileak, because you have removed the second and third segment. Sometimes the fourth segment can leak. There can be hemorrhage, there can be liver failure because of various things, sepsis, thrombosis. But yes, if you have done your pre-op evaluation well, and if your head was on your shoulder when you were doing the hepatectomy, most of the time you will not face this. Only a flamboyant approach towards doing donor surgery usually ends up into problems. You need your best people to really, in the given room, to deal with the donor's hepatectomy. Is donor mortality an issue? Yes, it is an issue. And in our country, irrespective of whatever the statistics are saying, individually, we all know that sometimes people have lost donors. And it can have a phenomenal impact on the program that you are running. So you should take enormous efforts not to end up with a donor mortality. Now coming back to the child will have some issues. This is a bile leak in a child. You can put pigtails, you can have, but you know, it is all or none law. Either you do good surgery or you have lots of issues. And tackling these issues means that recurrent surgeries or recurrent interventions may be required. So when we do any anastomosis, even with the Roux-en-Y, we try to put a stent in the anastomosis so as to decrease the amount of bile leak as much as possible. this is the most disastrous complication in pediatric age group, because the artery is very small, and because the artery is very small, the chances of sometimes getting thrombosis in the artery is possible. How do you know? Indirectly, on an ABG, you will immediately come to know that your artery is not doing well, but you have to do Dopplers. Again, the Doppler guy has not come or has come to do the Doppler is not an issue. You should learn how to do a Doppler yourself. It is not a big deal. After some attempts, you will be able to know how to do a Doppler properly, because it is a utmost importance to know how to deal with this. So then once, if it is there, yes, it is a tragedy and you need to open up as urgently as possible and try to salvage it. If you can't salvage it, there is no hope, then eventually you will have to do a retransplant. But the mortality is very high with hepatic artery thrombosis. Coming to portal vein thrombosis, see patients with, you can have patients who are Budd-Chiari syndrome. Sometimes they are prothrombotic, sometimes they have other issues, and sometimes they are under infused. Sometimes the length of the portal vein is not matched properly and there is some sort of turbulence, and you may end up with portal vein thrombosis. You have to have a very high suspicion for this, high index of suspicion, and then you, if it is so, you open and deal with it. And sometimes if it is not possible to open or it is delayed, then in that case you can actually use Glexine and other things to deal with the circumstances. So all these things, you know, what you know should have additionally is a good interventional radiologist to deal with all this. So other than that, acute renal failure, mainly drug related, mainly graft related, or sometimes primary graft failure, innumerable other problems can be there. And you should have a very good team with a very good dialogue to deal with all these things. Last but not least is these two things, small or large for size. If the graft is too small or too large, then there are other surgical techniques that you use to deal with these circumstances. You should know on table and deal with it. Last but not least is the recipient mortality. Recipient mortality is an important issue, and that issue has to be tackled, because, okay, you have taken consent, everything is okay, but the mother or the father who is going to be donating the liver, it is a matter of great sort of a trauma to them, and you have to handle this part very, very delicately. So generally, this is about, I would say, a very, very concise summary of, there are too many other intricacies which I have not included for the, because this is just an introduction to all of you. But I would say that anybody who is interested, they need to attend liver transplants, they need to go get trained for that, and they should not have this. Even those who are in their 40s and 50s who want to do the transplant, they should understand that your basic surgical skills are good enough, but you need a special training for doing this, and get trained properly, and there is enough training available in India also now. So I would thank you that, you know, this, it may sound a very complicated thing, but it is definitely worth it. So by saying so, I just hand over the mic to Sanjay.
Yes, sir, thank you for your talk. If I could request Sanjay Rao sir to go ahead with his talk at present, and maybe Vikram can follow later.
Yeah, all right. Am I audible? I do hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir, you're audible. You can begin.
Yeah, just give me a second. I'll just share my screen and I will get going. Is Dr. Vikram Raut online yet?
He is online, sir. He is online, yeah.
So maybe do you, okay, just a minute. Yeah, so what I'm supposed to do now essentially is to talk about, you know, the long-term effects. I will just need to leave and log in. I'm back online. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. You're audible.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Sorry. So I was tasked with talking about long-term outcomes, and I think it is important not to lose sight of this, because the procedure itself is such a surgical challenge, and you know, a lot of emphasis is on the surgical procedure itself, and that is not out of place, because a successful outcome requires a successful surgical procedure, and this is one of the few operations where the ultimate technique of the procedure has a lot of bearing on its outcome. You know, and it needs to be a precise procedure for precise outcomes. But the outcome of the patient itself depends on a lot of other things, and it's not just the surgical thing. And we have to realize and we have to understand what these outcomes are if we are going to send patients towards this kind of an intervention. Now, the survival after pediatric transplantation has significantly improved. So today, if you look at patient survival, the patient survival is almost 80%. At 10 years. So it's an excellent survival, and compared to a lot of other disease conditions that we manage, this is a remarkable outcome, considering that this science and technology in children is hardly two decades old. The graft survival, however, is much less. So for example, if you look at this curve and you look at the living donor, you have an 80% patient survival at 10 years, but your graft survival is only about 60% to 70%. That means that patients survive longer than the grafts, and that is because some patients do require retransplantation. So some of these grafts do deteriorate with time, and to pull patients through, a good number of patients do require retransplantation. But on the whole, the survival is really excellent. And now we have to talk beyond just survival, and the emphasis has shifted to long-term outcomes and quality of life. That's what I will allude to briefly in the next few slides. Now, the long-term issues related to liver transplantation essentially are guided by three problems. One is that over time, for reasons that are not completely understood, the liver graft starts to undergo damage. So there is some form of chronic graft rejection that we still have not fully understood. The other complication or other problem that is associated with long-term issues are lifelong or long-term immunosuppression. It is one thing to transplant an adult at 50 years for alcoholic liver disease, perhaps, and then, you know, he has a 10-15 year old lifespan. He's on immunosuppression for 10-15 years. It's a whole other ball game when you have a baby who's 1-2 years old with biliary atresia, whose immune system has not fully matured yet, and you start manipulating this child's immune system with immunosuppressive drugs right from the from infancy onwards. And this child, you expect to live for another 50-60 years. So how the immune system is going to respond and how the child is going to respond to this form of immune suppression over such a long time is still uncharted waters. It's still things that we are learning as we go. In addition to this, the disease that the child has had also has significant impact on long-term outcomes. Say, suppose there is a child who's had biliary atresia at birth. He has had multiple cholangitis as he grows forward. He's had portal hypertension. He's been in and out of hospital. Eventually, at 12, 13, 14 years, he gets transplanted. So he has had a decade-long existence with a chronic disease, and that also impacts their long-term outcome after transplantation. So these are important issues, and let us look at them a little more in detail. Now, there is a concept of what was called the ideal liver transplant survivor. This came out from a group in Canada, where they tried to define, saying, okay, if you want to look at what your outcomes are after transplantation, long term, you're not talking about immediate postoperative mortality here. They developed a concept of what is called an ideal liver transplant survivor. So ideal liver transplant survivor is one who has a sustained graft function. That means his liver graft function is excellent. He's not had retransplantation. He's not had chronic rejection. And he has got a normal liver function. He's got a normal ALT, his bilirubin is normal, his albumin is normal, and his gamma GT is normal. So this is a normal sustained graft function. So to call an ideal transplant survivor, he should have a sustained graft function. He should have no immune suppression related comorbidities. We will talk about these as we go forward because this is important. So he should have a normal liver function. So no complications related to immune suppression. In addition, he should not be on any additional medication. For example, he should not be on steroids. He should not be on antihypertensives. he should not require anti-seizure medication. So this is an ideal transplant survivor, a transplant survivor who has perfect graft function and very, very minimal immune suppression. And unfortunately, only about 30% of all pediatric liver transplant patients ever achieve this status. So a majority of them, almost 70% of liver transplant patients in childhood will not be ideal survivors. That means they will have something related to one of these three heads. And our business as transplant physicians is to see that this number increases as we go forward with improving understanding. So why do we get long-term graft dysfunction? Why is it that 70% of patients end up having problems over many, many years? So one of them is long-term graft dysfunction. And this is not unique to liver. The same thing happens in the kidney as well. The same thing happens in the heart as well. The same thing happens in the lung as well. So there is a process of chronic rejection. And this is a process that is not well understood. So what it results is a slow simmering inflammation in the graft. And over time, the graft undergoes fibrosis. And as I said, this is not unique to the liver. It happens in many other organs as well. Why it happens is not completely clear. It is thought that it is an antibody mediated kind of rejection, because most of the acute rejection is T cell mediated. So it is thought that chronic rejection over time is some form of antibody mediated rejection, or it is some form of an altered inflammatory response to this graft and chronic exposure, low grade antigen exposure over time. And unfortunately, today there is no definitive therapy for chronic rejection of any organ. So if you have a liver that is chronically rejecting over time, this child will end up with graft fibrosis, will end up with long-term graft dysfunction, and about 10 to 15% of children will require retransplantation in the long term because of chronic rejection. The other reasons why you could have graft dysfunction is you could have alloimmune hepatitis. So the immune system can cause autoimmune hepatitis, because in a normal person, it is called autoimmune hepatitis. Here, the liver belongs to somebody else, so it is called alloimmune hepatitis. You can have steatosis in the liver. You could have NASH kind of pathology in the liver resulting in graft fibrosis. You might have chronic arterial thrombosis, or you might have biliary strictures from your surgery, which over time have resulted in biliary cirrhosis or have resulted in thrombosis and cirrhosis in the liver. So if you do protocol biopsies, almost 70% of protocol biopsies will show fibrosis. So this is a process we do not understand very well. What we can limit is to make sure that we do not have surgical problems. What we make sure is to make sure that we have a good surgical technique, so thereby we reduce the incidence of long-term graft dysfunction. But it is an inevitable phenomenon that is going to happen over time. So what can we do to limit this? We can optimize immunosuppression, make sure that you don't do too much or too little. You regularly monitor liver functions, and at the earliest time of any blip, correct whatever is correctable. Image regularly to make sure that you are not missing thrombosis, you are not missing biliary strictures, etc., that can be very easily managed to prevent long-term graft dysfunction. The role of protocol biopsies, a lot of people do, but it's more for monitoring rather than for therapy. The next big set of complications in patients long-term are related to long-term immunosuppression. So one of the common things that are found is what is called post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorder. Now, most of the immune suppression that we give are immune suppression that tries to suppress the T cells, the T lymphocytes. So for some reason, you can have hypertrophy of B cell clones. And this is exaggerated when your patient is colonized with Epstein-Barr virus. So when you have a patient who is carrying EBV or Epstein-Barr virus in his body, and he's got clonal hypertrophy of B cells, some of these B cell clones can get unregulated, can get hypertrophied and develop lymphomas. And lymphoma is one of the most common forms of post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorder. This used to be very high in the early part of the development of liver transplant, as high as 10-15%. But today in contemporary practice, it's around 2-5%. What do? You manage it, by optimizing immunosuppression. You don't want too much immunosuppression, because you give too many immunosuppression, your EBV starts to flare up and your B cell starts to hypertrophy. So you monitor the EBV so that you know, as if your EBV titers are climbing, means your patients is over immunosuppressed. So you regulate the immunosuppression. You regularly watch for lymphadenopathy, both in the neck, in the abdomen, in the chest. And if you have this, you chase it, prove that there is this problem and treat it. The treatment is usually immunosuppression reduction or withdrawal. And if you have a robust lymphoma, that requires chemotherapy. The other problem with long-term immunosuppression is that these patients have stunted linear growth. They do not grow. And part of the reason they might not grow is because some of the pre-existing diseases that these children have, for example, children with alpha-1 antitrypsin, children with tyrosinemia, for example, they do not grow. They are stunted. And these will continue even after the transplantation. Excessive use of steroid can also cause stunted growth. So what do? You have to make sure that preoperatively also these children are managed well, because a lot of these patients before transplant, when they are in the community with chronic liver disease, often are malnourished. And that malnourishment has an impact on these patients. And even after transplant, sometimes they do not catch up. So optimal nutritional management pre-op is very, very important. Early steroid withdrawal, again, is extremely important. Long-term steroid use, all of us know, results in stunted growth. Post-operatively also, you need to have nutritional rehabilitation. Renal dysfunction is, again, a common toxicity of tacrolimus, the CNI that we use. Renal dysfunction is very common. About 2-3% of liver transplant patients end up with liver dysfunction and require kidney transplants subsequently. So managing these patients is important. Monitoring is extremely important. You have to spare and monitor the CNI regularly. You have to try and use other drugs to reduce the CNI exposure, closely monitor renal function with EGFR and cystatin C, not just creatinine, and monitor for metabolic syndrome, because steroid use and CNI exposure can result in hyperlipidemia, can result in diabetes, can result in metabolic syndrome. Lot of comorbidities from CNS also happens because of the initial disease they might have. For example, Wilson's disease, they may have infections around the time of your operation. They might have had strokes because of hypercoagulables or because of prolonged INRs at the time that they were having chronic liver failure. So all these comorbidities are things that we have to watch for and manage as we go forward. The other problem with all our children is they eventually hit adolescence. And all of us who deal with adolescent children or have adolescent children know that this is a very, very high risk period. Patients in adolescence who are transplant recipients, one of the highest periods of graft rejection or graft failure is during adolescence. For example, when you look at kidney failure, the highest incidence of graft loss is between 15 to 23 years of age. Similarly, in liver transplant, the highest incidence of graft loss is in the 15s and the early 20s. And this period of adolescence is extremely high risk across all solid organ transplants. And why does it happen? It happens because you have medication non-adherence. It is very common in this age group. You tell the child to take medicine, he will act as if he has taken the medicine and throw the medicine in the bin. You ask them to take it twice a day, they might take it once every 2 days. And this is difficult because there are a lot of social things that these children are adjusting to during that time. They probably are going to a new college. They are probably moving to a new city. They are getting new friends in new places. So all their support system that they had, they are in a school. The school knows that they have had a transplant. Their teachers are very, very sympathetic to their cause. Their friends are known to them. They support them. But this child finishes class 12 and then goes to a college. And here everything is new. Everything is loose. The teachers don't know them. Their friends don't know them. It's a period of great stress. And medical non-adherence is a common cause of graft loss during this time. In addition, as we know, adolescents are exposed to high-risk behavior. They develop autonomy from their family. The parents are not able to keep track. They try to mimic their parents, their friends, smoking, drinking, all these kinds of things start. And this high-risk behavior can result in significant graft loss. So this is a time that we as transplant physicians have to support these children towards transition. And most of the time, these children keep coming back to us even in their early 20s, though theoretically by this time, they should have gone to adult specialists. Infections as we go forward are very common. And in the long term, viral infections such as CMV and Epstein-Barr virus are things that we have to monitor. Now, quality of life in these children is important. It is well documented that it is lower than age-matched healthy peers, but is quite similar to other children with chronic diseases. For example, children with chronic renal failure, children with chronic asthma, children with chronic inflammatory bowel disease, for example, they are more or less similar to it. And it is important to understand that the quality of life does not improve with time. It is not that the longer the child is out of transplant, the quality of life improves. It remains more or less static as the child grows and spends more and more years post-transplantation. the key issues are related to treatment anxiety. What happens if I miss a dose? What's going to happen to me in the future? You know, is my liver going to fail? Other anxieties related to chronic medications, the stress of having to take these medications like clockwork regularly, to keep going to hospital for recurrent interventions, the fear of missing school due to medical problems, all of these result in a decreased quality of life, and these children need to be supported as we go forward. So these are issues, medical and quality of life, that these children will go through, and those that impact long-term outcome after chronic liver transplantation or after liver transplantation. And when we counsel families for liver transplantation, we have to put all this on the table. They need to understand what they are getting into. Like Shashank made a statement, we are replacing one disease of chronic liver failure, which we cannot treat, with another disease of chronic immunosuppression that we think we can manage, though we cannot really manage it completely. But it's definitely better managed than patients with chronic liver disease whom we cannot treat. So liver transplantation is another disease. It's a chronic disease, much like diabetes and hypertension. You manage it well, the patient has a good quality of life and a near normal existence. But if you do not manage it well, it can be hell. Right. Now, what is coming? What is happening in the future? Which was another one of the few things that we had to talk about. So one of this is what is called normothermic machine perfusion. Now, a lot of the problem during surgery that we have and early mortality that we have is because of poor graft function. So today we have technology where the liver can be put into a machine. It is perfused with normal blood at normal temperature. You can measure the blood biochemistry to make sure whether the liver is working properly. You can measure the amount of bile that is produced. You can study the quality of bile and decide whether this liver is going to work well or not when you put it in a child or put it in a patient. So this is especially useful in disease donor programs, especially when you are doing retrieval after cardiac death. So, or when you are doing marginal livers, you do not know whether this liver is going to function. You put it in a patient, it doesn't function, the patient dies. So instead of that, you can put it in a machine like this and see whether it works. And it has been documented by groups that do it that up to 70% of livers that were eyeballed and thought not suitable, when you put it in machine perfusion, actually work and can be used successfully in patients. The other use is that you can transport these organs over longer periods and longer distances because you are not worried about anaerobic metabolism. So this is something that is currently available even in India now, though it is still quite expensive.
Excuse me, sir, if I can interrupt, we are exhausting our time limit. So
okay.
Yeah,
I will just finish. I think just one more slide and I will end. So what we are looking at now as pediatric transplant physicians is one organ for life. You transplant it and that organ should last for the child's life. So tolerance is something that is being studied, and the ability to manipulate the immune system in a way that it handles and tolerates this graft. So this is where a lot of activity is currently going on. So I will terminate by saying that liver transplant still, despite all this, remains the only life-saving treatment for end-stage liver disease. This is one of our patients whom we transplanted almost 15 years ago. He is now entering medical school. So it has a good outcome, but it is a great, great challenge. And we need to understand just operating and finishing is not the end of the story. Thank you. I will stop here.
Thank you, Sanjay Rao, sir. Now Vikram is online. So Vikram, Dr. Rao? Vikram? Dr. Vikram? So we've exceeded the time limit. Can you finish your presentation in another 5-10 minutes and maybe summarize the panel discussion or whatever you can stress upon what the postgraduates need to know about liver transplant, especially in pediatrics?
So maybe I can finish my presentation. I have around 15 slides, but I will just summarize that in 10 to 15 minutes.
5 to 10 minutes.
10 minutes, yeah. And then I think Dr. Rao will summarize the whole session.
Yeah, please.
You need to allow me for sharing.
Yeah, 1 second.
So now you can share your slides.
Vikram, you can share your screen now.
Mera
Can you see my slides?
Yes, Vikram, we can see your presentation.
So the results for transplant are by and large about 30 to 40% transplants are for biliary atresia. The next major indication is the metabolic or genetic disorder. About 10 to 15% transplants are done for acute liver failure, and rest are from the tumor or chronic liver disease or other autoimmune diseases. At Apollo, about 50% of our transplants are done from biliary atresia. About 40% are done for post-Kasai, and about 15% are primary transplant for biliary atresia. One of the important indications we are seeing in the Western India is Bhartchari syndrome. When I was in Delhi, I didn't see this much patient, but around 18% patients are for Bhartchari syndrome. So I will just cover the important indications. So for biliary atresia, this is a systematic review reporting about 2,000 patients. And even after the 27 years, almost 80% patients have the graft and the patient survival. Yes, they, in the long term, they will have some kind of issues, as Dr. Rao already elaborated on that. But eventually, about 80% patients are alive even after 30 years after the transplant. So that's an important message. When you need to consider the transplant for biliary atresia, either it's for late diagnosis of biliary atresia, where you directly consider the primary liver transplant, or in terms of the failed Kasai enterostomy, which could be either showed by the development of cirrhosis, development of portal hypertension, or patient developing the recurrent cholangitis or failure to thrive. This is again the about 3,000 patients reported for biliary atresia, and it the mean survival, 5-year survival, is almost in a range of 75 to 80%. Obviously, these studies were older studies in before 2000, but after 2000, the survival outcomes are certainly improved. Another important indication for liver transplantation is acute liver failure, which is usually defined as absence of chronic liver disease and presence of coagulopathy, which is not responding to the vitamin K. Ideally, INR of 1.5 to 1.9 with encephalopathy, or if INR more than 2, regardless of encephalopathy. It is a presentation is quite acute, and the patients can deteriorate very rapidly. So you should discuss with the family, the plan for a transplant should be on the radar whenever the patient is going to be more sick. And you need to have a coordinated effort between the transplant hepatologist, intensivist, and surgeons. During this phase, it's also important to know that certain indications of acute liver failure are medically treatable, like herpes simplex, hepatitis, autoimmune hepatitis, or early presentation of Wilson's can be treated with the medicines. The liver transplantation is usually contraindicated in patients with multi-system mitochondrial disorders or patients with uncontrolled sepsis, and when there is irreversible brain damage. Also important to understand that certain indications of acute liver failure will require the certain other treatment like immunosuppression or bone marrow transplant if they present with hematopoiesis or lymphohistiocytosis. The metabolic disorders, again, I'm not going to go in a detail, but broadly can be classified for surgeons is whether they have the normal liver histology. So there will be a certain illnesses will have absolutely normal liver histology, and there will be a defect in a metabolism, or the toxins are produced by liver. So you need to transplant, and in certain indication, you can use this liver as a domino graft for other patients with end-stage liver disease. Also important to remember, this metabolic liver disease also have the extra hepatic manifestations, and they need to be controlled, or the prognosis need to be explained in that term. The Wilson's is important metabolic disorder, which we see in India, an important cause for a transplant. It either actually present as acute liver failure or chronic liver failure. Important to notice that certain neuropsychiatric manifestations, which may not be reversed after liver transplantation. So this needs to be consulted with a family. Another important indication for transplant in pediatric patients is tumors, and hepatoblastoma is one of them. Although the gold standard for treatment for hepatoblastoma is a palliative perioperative chemotherapy and followed by resection, but those with a pretext 3 and pretext 4 tumor should be considered for transplant. And discussion of transplant in these patients is very important, because the 10-year survival, if the patient has primary LT in unresectable hepatoblastoma, is almost 82%, where the rescue LT is, the survival is just about 30%. So the preoperative assessment should be involve the multidisciplinary team, and it should involve the transplant surgeon, hepatologist, anesthesiologist, infectious disease specialist, intensive care specialist, social worker, and transplant coordinator. Important parameter for assessment is the nutritional assessment, and although it is very often neglected assessment, about 70% patients with end-stage liver disease are malnourished, and the improvement in nutrition is associated with improved graft and a patient survival. These patients should be tried with enteral formula with medium chain triglyceride and fat soluble vitamins, because these deficiencies are often associated in these patients. And sometimes the tube feeding also helps to gain the weight. The cardiopulmonary assessment mainly involves the structural cardiac assessment, particularly in patients with biliary atresia and Alagille syndrome. There may be a structural defect associated. The end-stage liver disease patient often present with a cirrhotic cardiomyopathy, and which could aggravate during the peritransplant period, needs to look very carefully. The hepatopulmonary syndrome is often associated with end-stage liver disease, which should be evaluated by measuring the oxygen saturation to be confirmed with bubble echo or a mass scan. The portopulmonary hypertension often needs the cardiac catheterization. It is important to note that these patients should be properly vaccinated for age, and ideally vaccination should be restarted when the before development of end-stage liver disease. It is very important to note that the vaccines will work better when the patients were before transplant, and also they will work better before they develop the chronic liver disease. In India, it's very essential to assess the psychosocial and financial assessment, because the liver transplant itself is a disease, it's not a cure. Probably you are transferring the one which is life-threatening disease to the less life-threatening disease, and that counseling needs to be done to the family. The family needs to understand that there's a long-term cost involved, the long-term care involved, in terms of the immunosuppression and certain complications they might be developing during the long term. Also, it's important to notice that the kind of housing or the route of transportation they will take to assess the healthcare after the post-transplant period, it should be addressed. The finances is again the important consideration. But at Apollo Hospital, we have done almost 80% transplant are supported either through crowdfunding or through the charitable support. The dental assessment is particularly important in this patient, because almost 30 to 40% patients, the post-transplant sepsis originate from the dental caries or dental abscesses. Just briefly, I will explain, because Dr. Shotri told me to include this part. The potential donor counseling also needs to be done in these patients. Either it could be the deceased donation or the living donation. The deceased donation can be the full-size graft, which is very rare, because pediatric donations per se in India are very uncommon. You can have split graft or reduced graft. In living donor, if the child is very small, you need to use the left lateral or sometimes a monosegmented graft, or left or a right graft for older children. Usually in a living donor, we select the donor between 18 to 55 years of age. There should not be a other comorbidities or diabetes, hypertension should be well controlled. Patients should not be on the smoking or on a contraceptive pills. Ideally, BMI should be less than 28, but we can do up to 30 with a liver biopsy or fat estimation. The acceptable remnant should be about 30%. During perioperative period, we do the extensive workup of donors in terms of the hepatic artery anatomy. About 20 to 30% of donors will have some kind of anomaly, and that needs to be carefully evaluated before the transplantation. Sometimes we may get two arteries. Similarly, the portal vein anastomosis, the portal vein again from intrahepatic classification can be classified into the three or four types. The type A is normal, type A, B will be having the branching with a short stump of right lobe. Type C will be the trifurcation of portal vein. Type D again will be the trifurcation with the left branches arriving early. And type D or E are usually contraindication for a liver transplantation. Similarly, you need to assess the biliary, intrahepatic biliary anatomy. The type A classification will be the right anterior duct and posterior duct joining to form the right hepatic duct, and the right and left hepatic duct will form the common hepatic duct. But there will be a various variations which will outcome, which will affect the outcome of biliary anastomosis, which needs to be taken into account. So to conclude, the liver transplant is established as a definitive treatment for end-stage liver disease. Biliary atresia, acute liver failure, and metabolic liver disease and tumors are most common indications. And it does offer the long-term survival, and certain series, the 30-year survival is in tune of 80%. The patient should be evaluated with multidisciplinary team. And LDLT in India offers the timely transplant, and the financial challenges can be worked out. Thank you.
Thank you, Vikram, for your talk. Now we've actually overshot our time limit. So I would request Dr. Sanjay Rao sir and Dr. Shruti sir to just summarize the whole topic for our postgraduates.
I think we can take whatever questions, if people are willing, if they have questions, they can be put on the chat and we can reply. We will remain online for a few, maybe another 5-10 minutes time. So if people have questions, they can please put it on the chat. I realize that this is a slightly esoteric topic, but I think it is important that as pediatric surgeons, we learn about it and also try to get involved, because we owe it to our patients. And it is another technology, it's another skill that we should learn. So I think we will pause here, and if there are any questions that are raised, we can answer it on the chat. We'll remain on the chat for some time, maybe another 10 minutes or so.
Yeah, only thing I want to comment was just that the broadening of the horizons of pediatric surgery. So yeah. Try and push yourself and deal with this topic. It is possible to eventually excel in it as well. Thank you
very much.
I would like to thank Dr. Sanjay Rao, Dr. Shrotriya, and Dr. Vikram Raut for conducting this session. Now we'll quickly move on to the next session, which is the session on anorectal malformations. First, we'll have a case discussion. The presenter of this case will be Dr. Ashita Onni from Kanchi Kamakoti, Chennai, and the faculty for this presentation would be Dr. Sameer Kant Acharya, who is the MD of Pediatric Surgery at Safdarjung Hospital, New Delhi, and Dr. Himanshi Shah Madam, who is HOD of Pediatric Surgery at Nair Hospital, Mumbai. The second presenter would be Dr. Aniruddham from JIPMA. Dr. Ashita?
Is the person who's presenting there online? Yeah.
Dr. Ashita? Just give us a couple of minutes. Dr. Ashita?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Ashita, please start with the presentation.
Hello?
Yeah,
please, sir. We are presenting a case of 6-month-old male child. 6-month-old male child brought by parents. Informant was mother with reliability, good reliability, with chief complaints of history of absent anal opening from birth, for which he was operated in newborn period. Now he is admitted for further surgical management. Oh, history of present illness. Child was a firstborn child of a non-consanguineous marriage, delivered at term, birth weight of 3.2 kg. Child cried immediately after birth. Immediately after birth, no one noticed the absent anal opening, and child was started on breast pad after 4 hours, since it was an LSCS surgery, LSCS delivery. Following which, on day one, child started passing meconium through urethral opening, and day two, child started vomiting. Hence, they noted there is an absent anal opening, and child was referred to our hospital. Child undergo, there was no history of abdominal distension. Child undergone colostomy at day 3 of life, following which child was doing well. Child gained adequate weight. There's no further history of dysuria, urinary tract infections, hematuria. No history of fever, no history of stomal prolapse or retractions. No history of parastomal hernias or parastomal skin excoriations. There was no further admissions at hospital. There is a history of passage of whitish jelly-like material per urethra. It's occasional. Otherwise, child voiding well 6 to 7 times per day. And antenatal history. Uneventful antenatal period. With the mother was immunized and booked. Antenatal scans were told to be normal. There was no other family members had similar illness. Developmental history, child attained normal milestones for the age and immunized for the age. Diet history, child is on breastfeeding and formula feeds. Can I go to the examination?
So before you go on to your examination, what do you think is the provisional diagnosis on the clinical, on the history?
Since child had at newborn period passage of meconium through the urethra, it will be a rectourethral ARM, anorectal male anorectal malformation with a rectourethral fistula, ma'am. Because that meconium was coming without passage of urine. Spontaneously, okay. It was coming. So most probably a rectourethral fistula.
Okay. And do you think there's any other associated anomalies based on the history?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Fine. Go on to examination.
What other history you can have asked in this patient?
Is other associated anomalies regarding that any cyanosis at birth, breathing difficulties, or feeding difficulty, or any excessive salivations to rule out vectoral anomalies.
Vectoral anomalies. What are the other vertebral anomalies?
Spinal anomalies can be present, sir. Any lump over the spine, lower spine.
Yes.
Or whether the child is
scoliosis.
Yes, sir. Able to move all the four limbs freely.
What are the limb anomalies in these cases?
Radial agenesis, sir, limb anomalies can be there.
What is that known as? Radial ray.
Radial rays.
Okay. So what are the associated anomalies in ARM cases?
Main is the vectoral anomalies, sir, with the vertebral cardiac anomalies, renal anomalies, and limb anomalies, sir. And tracheoesophageal anomalies.
Okay, you can go to general exams.
So, on examination, child was active, alert, moderately built and nourished. no facial dysmorphisms were present. Weight of 7.5 kg, height 65 cm, and pulse rate 116 per minute, BP 94/73 with mean of 79. Respiratory rate is 30 per minute and temperature 98.8 degrees Fahrenheit. There was no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, or edema or lymphadenopathy. Next slide.
What is your local examination?
Yes. Coming to the abdominal examination, on inspection, abdomen was flat with central umbilicus. There was a single stoma in left ilia fossa with two lumens, one above the other, with an, which is located in the lateral position of an oblique scar. Mucosa of the stoma was healthy and pink in color. No peristomal excoriation or parastomal herniation noted. No stomal prolapse or retraction noted. Otherwise, all other part of the abdomen was, skin was free and there was no other scars or sinuses, no dilated veins or obvious swellings noted. Palpation, on probing test, there was fecal staining in the upper opening. Otherwise, all other part of the abdomen was soft, non-tender and no palpable masses were noted. Percussion, liver dullness was present from fifth intercostal space with the liver span of 11 cm. Abdomen was resonant in all parts. Bowel sounds were present in auscultation. Perineal examination. There was absent anal orifice noted with an hyperpigmented anal dimple present at the site of normal anal position. Deep natal cleft with well-developed gluteal folds noted. Midline raphae was normal with no fistulous opening or hyperpigmentation. Scrotum was well-developed with bilateral descended testis. Penis was normal with normal position of meatus. Sacrum was clinically normal. Other systems were normal.
So what is your diagnosis after clinical examination?
Case of male anorectal malformation with the rectourethral fistula on sigmoid loop colostomy.
Okay,
no obvious congenital anomalies associated.
No obvious anomalies and no colostomy complications also, right?
Yes, yes. Okay. Stoma related.
Okay, fine. So just looking at that clinical picture of the baby that you described, the perineal, looking at this, what do you think the prognosis is going to be?
The gluteal folds are well formed with the deep natal cleft, ma'am. So most of the muscle development, perineal muscle development will be good. So the outcome should be good in this child.
So you'll be able to tell the parents that it's a reasonably good outcome postoperatively.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And is the patient on any washouts?
No, ma'am. Child is not on any washouts.
Okay. Would you like to have that?
Distal washes. Since the child is on a loop colostomy, there is a chance of spillage of stool from the proximal stroma to the distal stroma. So it is advisable to give washes once in a month or once in 2 weeks, ma'am, to keep the distal part of the rectum free.
Once in 2 weeks.
In neonatal period prior to going for a colostomy, what are the investigations you will do?
So, we have to rule out all the anomalies, sir. So echocardiogram to rule out the cardiac anomalies, ultrasound abdomen to look for renal status, and in newborn period we can also do ultrasound spine and cranium to rule out any sacral anomalies, sir. And X-ray abdomen and spine to look for any spinal anomalies.
Do you need an invertogram or CTPL in this case?
Yes, sir. To look the extent of the distal rectal shadow, we have to do a CTPL.
No, in a case of fistula where there is you have seen meconidia, there is no need for an invertogram. So how will you do an invertogram?
Cross prostable, sir?
Previously we were doing in photogram, and yes, recently we are doing prostable lateral X-ray in a prone position.
Yes, sir.
Do you know how to do a in photogram?
Yes, sir. We have to hold the child upside down with flexed hip and giving support to the head, and keep the child in that same position for at least 3 minutes so that the air will go up into the distal rectum. Then in a lateral position with the both greater trochanters in the same region, we have to take the film, sir, and focusing the X-ray into the greater trochanter.
Trochanter, yes, and both the femurs should be superimposed.
Yes, sir, and place an radio opaque material at the proposed anal site.
When should you do an invertogram?
After 18 hours, sir. 18 hours to 24 hours later. After
birth. Okay.
Why? By that time only normal rectal shadow will be visible, sir. Minimum 24 hours is the time we will wait for the passage of meconium in a normal child. So we have to keep the time period for the meconium and the air to come to the distal rectal portion.
So what are the various landmarks in an invertogram?
There is a PC line and eye line we can make out in invertogram, sir. PC line is the pubococcygeal line connecting middle part of the boomerang pubic bone and the just caudal to the last ossified sacral bone, sir.
Sacral bone, that is PC line. The eye line?
Eye line will be the ischial coma, the lowermost end of the ischial coma, that is the eye point. Making parallel line to the PC line, we have to make an eye line, sir.
So whenever you see if the sacral pieces are not there, sometimes developmental, 2 to 3 sacral pieces are missing, then how will you do the PC line?
We can make a line connecting pubis and the ischial upper 3/4 and lower 1/4 of the ischium.
That is upper 1/4 and lower 3/4. Okay. That is the line that crosses the PC line. What is the significance of PC line?
PC line is the level of perineal muscles is attaching to the sacrum.
That is, what are the perineal pelvis muscle? That is basically the levator line. So the high anomalies is known as the supralevator anomalies, and the low anomalies are below the PC line. In which way the CTPL, crosstable lateral X-ray, is better than the invertogram?
Crosstable, in this the child CTPL and child will be more comfortable, and child will not be crying much, and it is more physiological X-ray, sir. In the invertogram there will be more chances of aspirations, and the child will be irritable, and the level of the lower rectum itself cannot be taken correctly, sir. When the child is crying and the levator,
when the child is crying, the pelvic anal muscle, the perineal muscles are contracting, so yes, a low anomaly can look like a high anomaly. In that,
yes, sir.
Do you know who have described the PC and this CTPL, crosstable lateral X-ray?
Rao, sir.
Dr. K.L.N. Rao from PC.
K.L.N. Rao.
But that is well accepted worldwide nowadays. How many percent is cases of ARMs they need an invertogram? Like in this case, where there is a rectal urethral fistula meconium, we don't need an invertogram. So most of the low ARMs don't need an invertogram. So almost 10% we only need an invertogram.
Okay, sir.
In a plain X-ray abdomen in an ARM, what are the features you will see?
We have to rule out pouch colons in plain X-ray, sir. The presence of large pouch which is occupying more than half of the diameter of abdomen. And we have to look for any spinal anomalies, lumbosacral vertebral anomalies.
And also in the erect X-ray, you can see some perforation. Because in the long standing case, there can be perforation. What is sacral index? What is its significance?
Sacral index will be seen in lumbosacral X-ray, sir. It is a ratio between, there is 3 points, sir, iliac crest and the lower border of the sacroiliac joint and the tip of the sacrum. The ratio between tip of the sacrum and the lower border of the sacroiliac joint divided by the upper ratio, sir, the sacroiliac joint and the iliac crest. So this ratio, it is normal is 0.74 in AP, and the lateral view it is 0.77. If it is less than 0.4, it shows there is low chances of continence for the child. Prognosis of the child will be done with using this.
So there is a question in the chat box. What is the significance of Down syndrome in ARM?
Down syndrome children will have mostly ARM without fistulas.
Without fistulas?
Yes.
So here in this case, you have said you have done a sigmoid colostomy.
Yes, sir. Proximal sigmoid, it's in the descending one, yes.
So what is the other type of colostomy described?
It can be loop colostomy or divided colostomy.
Which is better?
Divided colostomy is better to avoid the spillage of stool from the proximal stoma to the distal.
And what are the other advantages?
So that trichloma formation will not be there in the distal lumen.
In case of loop stoma, there is more chance of formation of trichloma formation.
Yes.
There can be more chance
prolapse
of UTI.
Also.
Because fecal content can go to the urinary tract, there can be more chance of UTI.
Yes, sir.
So these are not, and there is easy wash out can be given in case of a divided stoma.
Yes.
Can you do a transverse colostomy in these cases?
Yes, sir, we can do transverse.
Which is better, transverse colostomy or sigmoid colostomy?
Sigmoid is better. As a transverse colostomy, there is more chances of prolapse is noted.
There is a long segment in it, definitely sigmoid colostomy is better and it is always practiced. And in case of transverse colostomy,
washes will be difficult.
Segment and with the distal dilatation, there is a very difficult, you know, distal washouts. And yes, there is more chance of, if there is urinary spillage, there can be uremia and
everything. Okay.
So in a sigmoid colostomy, which part you will do a stoma?
The proximal sigmoid, the junction of the descending colon and the proximal sigmoid, sir.
Okay. Why?
So that the prolapse chances are less and the full length of the sigmoid can be used for a pull through. I mean,
you can get adequate length.
Yes.
Adequate length for future surgeries.
Yes.
So here in this is a case ARM 6 month old baby with sigmoid colostomy. How will you proceed?
At this stage, we have to do a pressure augmented distal colostogram to look for the site of fistula and length of the distal rectum, sir, and the position of the rectum. According to that, we can plan the surgery.
So how do you do a pressure augmented distal colostogram? Can you describe the procedure?
Yes, ma'am. Under fluoroscopy, we have to insert a Foley's catheter into the distal lumen and inflate the balloon and stretch the balloon and slowly instill contrast material into the distal colon and the rectum until we are seeing the fistulas opening into the urinary tract.
Why do you need it to be pressure augmented?
It will, the pressure is needed to open up the fistula and delineate the fistula correctly.
Yeah, to open up the sphincter complex around it so that it can, the fistula can be delineated. So yes. Read the distal colostogram, please. What does this show?
This is a distal lumpogram study showing there is connection, the fistula's opening is noted at the bulbar urethra region.
Yes.
With the distally, it is going to the anterior urethra, and some filling into the bladder is also noted.
Yes, that indicates it's a large fistula, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So after this, what else do you want to do after the distal program?
Can there be a fistula without a fistula's communication?
It can be sometimes blocked with the meconium or fecaloma.
So how can you assure that there is a fistula in a distal colostogram?
Sir?
How can you be sure that there is a fistula in absence of looking for it? In the film, there is a fistula.
When MCU, we are doing an MCU, there will be beaking of the urethra noted at the site of fistula.
It's not beaking the urethra, it is beaking of the distal end of the colostomy, the lower end of the distal pouch. Lower end of the distal pouch, if there is a beaking, then there can be a chance of fistula, even if the normal urethral tract is there. In a distal colostogram, how will you decide whether the pressure is adequate?
The distal end of the rectum will, initially it will be flat, and when we are giving a extra pressure, it will become bulging and it will narrow down into a
convex
fistula.
So if it is the lower end is convex, then you think that the pressure is adequate.
Yes.
What are the complications of a pressure augmented distal colostogram?
It can
and
cause
what contrast agents you will use?
This non-ionic contrast medium should be used, sir. Isotonic.
Why not barium?
Barium, it will be difficult to remove the barium following the lupogram studies. It can precipitate in the area and
barium
and any preparation
can go from the picaloma. So most of the times there is chances of formation of picaloma. Another is, if there is a perforation, the whole bowel will be matted and the barium will remain lifelong in the patient. So it is always our advice, water soluble contrast. Yes, you can proceed. What madam is asking about what other investigation will do?
So which are
the
investigations you're looking at? Before you proceed with that, in the distal leukogram which we saw, it's necessary to note that there is no presence of fecaloma and the distal segment is adequate for a pull-through procedure when you read the X-ray.
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. So please proceed. What other investigations do you want?
We can do MCU to rule out vesicular urethral reflux.
How many of these patients have associated VUR?
10 to 15%.
In high RM, almost more than 40% have associated VUR. In intermediate, it's 15 to 20%. Okay. Then what else do you need?
Then echocardiogram to rule out if any cardiac anomalies, and ultrasound abdomen to look for the kidney status.
Okay.
And other basic investigation for hemoglobin coagulation profile and renal function test.
Okay, so I think the 2D echo was normal, right?
Ah, yes, ma'am.
MCU is not showing any reflux. Is
no
it?
Reflux.
No. Okay, reflux. What do you want to do next?
What percentage of patients with ARM have cardiac anomalies?
50 to 60%.
Only 1/3 of patients, around 33% cases, and 10% of severe cardiac anomalies, they need surgery.
Okay.
Yes. What will you do next?
We will plan for surgery, sir. The posterior sagittal anorectoplasty, after getting an anesthetist opinion, we'll post the child for surgery.
One day prior to surgery, what will you do? How will you prepare the child?
Child will be admitted one day before the surgery, sir. And distal bowel washes will be started, and 12 hours, one day prior to the surgery, by afternoon we will keep the child in nilpar oral and will give distal bowel washes till it is clearing out. No fecal matter should be there in the distal bowel. And child will be started on antibiotics and blood will be preserved for the surgery.
There is a question, what is the role of primary PSAP without a colostomy?
In the neonatal period, when the patient presents to you, what are the advantages of a primary PSRP? What is the role of a primary PSRP?
In high anomalies, it will be difficult to do primary PSRP. Intermediate anomalies, we can try, but it's better to go for a colostomy and later on with adequate distal colostogram, adequate imaging studies to show the level of the fistula, it will be easy to perform the PSARP.
If you not do a colostomy and direct go for a PSRP, what are the problems you will face?
Identification of the, in higher anomalies, the rectum will not be seen immediately in the PSARP position. Sometimes the child may need abdominal approach to identify the mobilization of the rectum, and more chances of injury to the urethra and the vas and the seminal vesicles is there in newborn children.
Yes.
So I think it would be safe to say that you would only attempt a primary PSRP in patients who have a good birth weight, who have more associated malformations, have presented to you early with an intermediate ARM which is very well delineated on the cross-table view, and there's no distension, and that it's an experienced, a very senior experienced person, right, who has enough surgical experience, right?
Yes.
Okay. So for this patient, we're going to do a PSRP, right? So can you just give a few salient features, surgical steps of the PSRP? Not the entire procedure, just a few salient steps.
Yes. So under general anesthesia, we have to first catheterize the bladder, and child should be placed in a prone position with pelvis elevated, and using muscle stimulator, the anal muscle complex site should be identified and marked, and incision will be placed from the tip of the coccyx up to the anterior border of the muscle complex, and the incision will be deepened in the midline. We have to stay in the midline to avoid injury to the nerves and vessels. And initially, we will, after opening skin and subcutaneous tissues, there will be parasagittal fibers will be noted, following which levator ani muscles will be opened posteriorly, and anteriorly there will be vertical fibers, that muscle complex fibers will be seen. All the muscles should be opened midline. After that, rectum will be identified. And the stay stitches should be taken in the rectum, and rectum opened posteriorly in the midline, and the incision should be extended up to the visualization of the fistula. Once we have seen the fistula, stay stitches should be taken around the fistula, and separation of rectum from the urethra should be done. Mobilization of the rectum laterally should be done first, following which anterior mobilization. Initial mobilization will be submucosal, following which full thickness mobilization of the rectum from the urethra should be done. Once adequate length of the rectum is gained, the length should be gained by dissecting the rectum close to the rectal wall, so that the rectum will be getting intramural blood supply. Once the adequate length is gained, we have to place the rectum in the proposed anal site, close the muscle complex fibers anterior to the rectum, and then fix the rectum to the mucosa, to the skin, and then posterior muscle fibers should be closed.
What is the care you take while doing the anterior dissection of the rectum? What are the precautions you take?
Urethra should be palpable with the Foley's catheter in the urethra, ma'am. Should be careful not to injure the urethra anteriorly.
Yeah, so after the fistula, approximately 1 centimeter of the resection should be carried out submucosal before you go full thickness on the anterior wall. Because it's a common wall and you don't want to damage the urethra anteriorly, right?
Yes.
So, I have a question. What is the position known as in this case? What is the position?
Prone jackknife position.
Modified jackknife position. And you should pad the baby's legs so that there will not be injury to femoral knob and stretch injuries.
Yes.
If you go in the midline, why it is very important to go in the midline?
The vessels and nerves will be lateral in position, sir. So midline will be a bloodless field and there will be minimal damage to the nerves.
Not so much. What are the muscles you will see while going midline?
Parasagittal muscle fibers and yes. muscle complex which are vertical muscles, sir. And
so what are those vertical fibers? Where they connect?
They're the puborectal muscles.
No. The vertical fibers, otherwise known as the muscle complex fibers, they connect from the skin to the levator muscles. Where will you play the answer for why you in the midline? If you go to one side, the muscles will be dissected outside other side, and will you enter into the head plane? So you cannot keep the rectum in a proper position. What are in which place you can keep the rectum for the future anus, new anus?
So you'll find the position using muscle stimulators, sir. Parasagittal fibers are crossed with the vertical fibers.
Entry and posterior limit where the fibers, parasagittal and vertical fibers cross, it's there. Yes. You can keep in the muscle complex rectum.
Yes.
If you what are the other surgical procedures apart from PSAP? PSAP described by which surgeon?
Penis, sir.
Prior to penile surgery, what are the surgeries practiced?
Stephen's procedure.
What are
sacroperineal, these? Sacroperineal
procedures. Sacroperineal and sacroabdominoperineal procedures.
Yes.
So prior to penile's PSRP, no one have dividing the puborectal sting. They're dividing the midline. What is the continence in these babies?
They were having more chances of constipation because of the puborectal sling.
No more chance of constipation. Is not the answer.
I am not sure, sir.
So, what is the postoperative care you will take for this patient?
So this child will be having colostomy postoperatively also. So the child can be started on feeds when child is awake, and following which child will be discharged. And after 2 weeks, we have to start the child on anal dilatations.
When will you remove the Foleys?
Foleys, by third or fourth day, we will remove the Foleys. And...
Okay. And you start the anal dilatations on?
After 2 weeks post-surgery.
After 2 weeks. And rectal washouts? Or distal stoma washouts?
After 2 weeks, once. We used to follow only
ideally
dilatations.
Most of us give rectal washouts, distal stoma washouts to our patients soon after the stoma is done, till the definitive procedure, and continue it for some time so as to keep the colon size deflated, right? Now, if this patient were to come to you, because this patient seemed to have a very good sphincter complex and an intermediate anomaly, right? If this patient comes to you in the postoperative period, let's say after 3 to 6 months, saying that he's got incontinence, how would you proceed with investigating that? Vipul, do we have the time? Okay, go on, madam.
So we have to check the patency of the pull-through bowel in a rectal examination, whether there is any stenosis or the bowel is adequate in diameter.
and if there is any retraction of the rectum, should be noted. Incontinence, ma'am, or constipation?
You tell me. I'm saying it's incontinence. How do you want to assess it further? The mother has come back saying that there is some stool staining. So you think it could be because of constipation?
Since the muscle development is good, there is more chances of constipation.
Yes, and the incontinence which the mother is talking about could be a pseudo incontinence, which is because the child is severely constipated, right?
Yes.
So the way to assess is to first look at the inner orifice clinically, see whether there's any retraction, prolapse, any tightening of the sphincter over there. Do a porectal examination, look for any long segment stenosis, look for if there is fecal matter which is present inside, there's a fecaloma inside. Okay,
yes.
And then you can assess how do you want to carry it further. If it is constipation leading to pseudo incontinence, then the best thing to do is to start the child on rectal washouts, which will treat the problem, and give a diet which will help treat the constipation also. Yes. What are the chances that this is a true incontinence, even in this patient?
There is chances, ma'am, due to... If the position of the...
Technical considerations, like if the rectum has been displaced outside the sphincter complex, it's not in the midline, that could also cause it. But that is very unlikely to happen, right?
Yes.
What are the various scoring system to assess the soiling?
Kelly score, and Pina score and can be used.
What
the
is
time of the number of times of constipation, soiling, and sphincter sphincter tightening will be examined and will be scored good or bad and intermediate in the gradings. And according to the number of score of the patient, we can decide whether the child is having incontinence or not.
The Kelly score of 6 is whether it's good, poor, or fair.
6 is good, sir.
Excuse me, all the speakers. We have just 5 minutes more to go.
Yes, thank you, Gayatri.
Okay. Now, last question. What are the different classifications used in auricular malformation?
Initial classification was the Wingspreadt's classification in 1984, sir. That was dividing into the high, intermediate, and low. Then Pina's classification dividing into male ARM and female ARM. The recent classification in 2005 is the Kirkenbusch classification with the major clinical group and rare groups.
What are different rare clinical groups?
Rare clinical groups are rectovaginal fistula, H-type fistulas, and rectal atresias, and cloacasts.
So, in the Kirkenbusch classification, there are regional variants. So, the name Kirkenbusch signifies what?
There is a place where the meeting was held.
Where is that place? That is basically Kirkenbusch Castle in Germany.
Okay.
And what are the different prognostic factors that determine the future following PSR?
The spinal anomalies and the sacral ratio, sir.
Sacral ratio, presence of number of sacral pieces, one. Another?
Presence of
midline, a prominent midline raphe that implies a good muscle complex is there. And third is different variety of ARMs. Which ARMs have good prognosis?
Low ARMs.
Low ARMs, yes.
Yes.
Another?
An intermediate will have?
Cases of rectal atresias.
Yes.
Rectal atresias. Cloacas with common channel length less than 3 cm, they have good prognosis. And complex, whereas complex malformations, cloaca more than 3 cm, they have poor prognosis.
Yes.
Okay. Do you, do you know what is the development in how the ARMs, where there is a defect in the developmental in ARM?
In high ARMs, it is the cloacal membrane rupture and the formation. And low ARM, the cloacal division, the urorectal septum division is defective. Occurs in the 6 to 10 weeks of life in the antenatal
phase. At around 6 weeks, 3 weeks the cloaca is formed. By 6,
7 weeks, rupture.
There is by 6th week, there are urogenital sac and there is a anorectal sac. And by 7th week, there is the urorectal septum ruptures to form 2 rings. Can go detail
for
that.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, sir. Sir, the next case is of female ARM. So I think the all the female ARM in the discussion can be done at that point. I just can allow one more question now. If there are no more questions, can we move on to the next session? Okay, so we'll move on to the next session. Thank you so much, Dr. Sameer Acharya and Dr. Himanshu Shah Madam for being the faculty for this session. And very good presentation by Dr. Ashita. Thank you so much. We'll move on to the next case, which is a female ARM case discussion. The faculties for this session is Dr. Ashish Bakalu, who is a consultant pediatric surgeon at KGMC Lucknow, and Dr. Bijal Sambhi Ma'am, who is a professor of pediatric surgery at KM Hospital, Mumbai. The presenter would be Dr. Amit B. from Safdarjung Hospital, and the co-presenter is Dr. Himanshu Verma from the Safdarjung Hospital. So we'll be sharing the slides, and Dr. Amit, you can start the case presentation.
Hi, good afternoon. Okay, Dr. Amit, I guess we are slightly behind time, so let us go quickly to the presentation, please.
Sir, we'll keep half an hour for this case, sir.
Yeah, we've got 30 minutes, so we want
yes.
Rather than looking, seeing the slide, take 7 days. Sir, go on.
Ask.
Yeah, next slide. Next, I'm sure everybody's read that.
Dr. Amit, can you start with your history, please?
Yeah, I was unable to unmute. Am I audible?
Yes, Amit, you are audible. Please go on.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I'll be presenting a case of the patient by name Baby of Deepthi, who's 2 days old, female patient, and she's from Delhi, and the informant is father, and who is quite reliable. Next slide, please.
Dr. Amit?
Yes.
Do you have two devices in the room? One person will have to switch it off. We are having an echo.
Okay.
Yeah, continue, please.
Passing meconium from the vestibule. Please go on.
There is absent anal opening since birth, chief complaints, and the passing meconium from the vestibule. History of presenting illness, there is absent anal opening since birth. There is no complaints of abdominal distension. There is complaint of passing meconium from the vestibule. And there is no complaint of vomiting. Patient has passed clear urine and feed was given thrice in the past 24 hours and patient is tolerating oral feeds.
Next, please.
Birth history, it's a full term normal vaginal delivery. Birth weight was 2.8 kgs and it was a home delivery. And the patient cried immediately after birth.
One question at this point. What about antenatal ultrasound?
So there was no antenatal ultrasound done for this patient, sir. Patient was in the home delivery and home care was taken. There was no antenatal care that was given to the mother.
You said the patient hailed from Delhi. Then why wasn't there an ultrasound? Were they in the outskirts or in rural area? What was the reason for no ultrasound?
sir, outskirts, and they were of low socioeconomic status, so they were not.
Okay, yes, please go on.
Okay. Next question. Family history. They have three children. The first is female, 8-year-old, who is healthy, and the male child, second is male, 3-year-old, who is healthy, and the third is the female child, which is the patient, the present patient.
Okay, so from this organization chart, it seems that the patient patient's father is a stepfather, because you have shown two children from the father and one from the mother.
No, sir, actually the charting has come out in this way. It's actually both of them.
I'm just clarifying the doubts for the audience. Okay. Next slide. Yes, please.
The general examination, the child is alert and crying. There is no sinus, clubbing, pallor or edema. His child is moving all the four limbs. There is no gross anomalies visible. The pulse rate of the child was 125 per minute. Respiratory rate was 30 per minute. And saturation was 99% on donor.
Okay, quick question.
Next slide.
Clubbing,
yes.
Baby. Do you clubbing?
No, sir. We don't expect and in a clubbing in such a baby.
Mention it here.
Yes.
Okay, go on, please.
On systemic examination, just there was bilateral air entry present, there were no added sounds, and S1, S2 cardiac sounds were present, there were no murmurs. Parabdomen was soft and non-distended, spine, there was no gross spine abnormality which was seen or palpated.
Okay, quick question. What were you looking for specifically when you palpated the abdomen?
Sir, abdomen, I wanted to check if there was any distension of abdomen or no. And since this is a case of female ARM, I just wanted to see if there is any lower abdominal distension which is present. Or
Dr. Amit,
what
would
that suggest?
Inspections. When you palpated the abdomen, you have written soft. But anything else you were specifically looking for on palpation? Distension is a finding of inspection. You see that it is swollen up, it is, you know, tumescent, and you say it is distended. Then you try to palpate the abdomen. What were you specifically palpating the abdomen for in this particular patient, who is today-old baby with an ARM? You have mentioned correctly,
sir. Sir, that is what, sir, if there is any hydrometrouretus.
Again?
Hydrometrouretus, any pelvic mass which is palpable.
Hydrometrocolpus,
sorry.
Sorry?
Hydrometrocolpus.
Hydrometrocolpus.
In a pelvic mass which is palpable.
Associated with the ARN. Something more common.
Sir, if there is any mass, anterior mass which.
What is commoner than a hydrometrocolpus in female ARN? Proglycal mass. May be reported by the parents also. Okay, go on.
Genitalia examination, vestibule is normally appearing, and meconium staining is seen in the vestibule. Labia majora and minora are well developed. Clitoris appears normal. Three openings seen in the vestibule, which were catheterized separately with 6 Frank infant feeding tube. The anterior most catheter drained urine, the middle catheter there was no drainage of any fluid, and the posterior catheter was stained with meconium.
Okay. Yeah, that's the picture. Okay. And you also done a contrast. Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The first
contrast is not done, sir.
Oh, the presentation that they sent me had a contrast X-ray.
So no contrast X-ray was done.
Describing you have.
Sorry.
Continue.
The presentation that was sent to me had a contrast.
I didn't understand the question. We don't do conference anymore for a female ARM in our hospital. So we
give me a second. Can I share my screen?
There was a mix-up in the slides. There was no contrast enema done in this case.
No comments.
Yeah, yeah.
Because for which patient will you do a contrast enema? In a female ARM, which patient will you do a contrast enema, Dr. Amit?
Sorry, ma'am. Hello?
In which patient would you like to do a contrast enema in a female ARM? You have correctly said you will not do it in this patient. In which patient would you like to do it?
If two openings are present, then I'd like to do a genitogram and retrograde this one. Minimum.
All right. And in any other conditions, in an older child? If the child presents to you at 3 years of age, would you like to do a barium enema from the fistulous opening?
If it's a case of H-type fistula where...
Suppose there was a girl, an older child with a vestibular fistula, as madam is asking. There was an older child with a vestibular fistula. Would you do a contrast?
No, sir. It's not needed if it is there's a vestibular fistula which is present with other two openings present in the vestibule, then I wouldn't prefer doing this.
Okay, we'll ask you this question again once we discuss the management. Now, what is the importance of the first line that you have written on this slide?
European folds are poorly developed.
What is the significance?
So that means the chances of continence is quite less as per the image which is there in the next slide, sir. Based on that, it mainly signifies the continence after surgery.
Once you are, the gluteal folds are poorly developed. You have seen that on examination. What is the image?
Yes, sir.
Thing that you should examine and tell us categorically in a child with female ARM, you are seeing poorly developed gluteal folds. So what is the immediate next examination that you should do and loudly say whether there is a positive finding there or negative finding there? Because I'm surprised to see you have not mentioned that word anywhere in these slides. She's got a flattish perineum, right?
Yes, sir.
Normally, as per the clinical picture of three openings in the perineum, is a low or an intermediate type of anomaly, right?
Yes, sir.
And low or an intermediate anomaly, as in this patient, with a flat perineum, what is your next most important examination? Immediately. It's part of the perineal exam.
Spinal examination.
Spine your is grossly normal.
Yes, sir. Spine is grossly normal. The next is presence or absence of an anal dimple that I have to see.
You can see pigment in the side of the anus. There is no dimple.
Yes, sir.
Where the child's labia are not retracted, there is no clear cut dimple. There is pigmentation. So what should you immediately check for? Flat perineum, poorly developed gluteal folds, child having a low or an intermediate anomaly. Why is she having these poorly developed gluteal folds and flat perineum? What will you check for immediately? And it's on clinical examination. It is not an investigation. Starts with an S. After that, there's A, C, R. Come on, Amit. U. I don't think I should spell it out any further than that.
I think he mentioned
that you should check when you have got a baby with a flat perineum and poorly developed gluteal folds. You have written the spine is grossly normal, but you haven't mentioned anything about the sacrum.
Sacral agenesis should be mentioned.
Should be checked for the presence of all sacral pieces or less than the number of... See, ARM, if you don't mention sacrum, that examination is incomplete. You are mentioning that she has got poorly developed gluteal folds. You can see a relatively flat perineum, which is unusual because the child has got a low or an intermediate anomaly. So you should particularly, please remember it. Check for the sacrum, mention that it's not. Why I got confused with the contrast that you sent me with the earlier presentation, that showed a complete sacrum. So I was a little confused why the child is having poor gluteal folds. Okay, let's go back. Next slide or next part of the examination. Sacrum should not be missed in anorectal malformation.
Yes, sir.
Right.
There is no anal dimpling seen. By the time of examination, there was no meconium staining. There is no buccal dental stain and no fistula, perineal fistula seen, sir.
Do you ever see bucket handle anomaly in a female?
No, sir. We don't see bucket handle anomaly in a female.
No bucket handle. Why don't you see bucket handle? Why don't you
see? Usually, in the case of male ARM, there is usually an intermediate and high fistula which are present. Whereas in a female ARM, these are intermediate and low which open between the vestibules. So there is no, this one for increased pressure and escape of the formed meconium which has to come out. So there is usually no bucket handle type of pain which is present.
In a male patient, you have got a prominent midline scrotal raphae. If that raphae continues over the definitive site of the anus and has a fistula behind it, then you get a bucket handle anomaly. Because a female doesn't have a scrotum, therefore no scrotal raphae, therefore no continuity over the anus, and therefore they cannot have a bucket handle deformity. And it's not a bucket handle tear, it's a bucket handle deformity. Okay?
Deformity.
Right. And you're writing no fistula seen, but there is a fistula in the vestibule.
Perineal fistula which is... Perineal fistula which is not present, instead of mentioning it that way, I just mentioned it.
According to you, vestibule is not part of the perineum?
No, sir, outside the vestibule. I'm outside the vestibule, not within the vestibule, so outside the vestibule.
Right. Okay, go on, please.
My diagnosis based on... The examination is rectovestibular fistula, sir. Based on this, my investigation, I would plan would be...
Hold on. Discuss this rectovestibular fistula business. So, which part of the examination enabled you to determine that this is a rectovestibular fistula?
The terminology is not used nowadays. The vestibular fistula is used according to the Krippenberg classification. But when I had introduced the infant feeding tube within the vestibular anus, it was going in the posterior and the superior direction instead of a posterior and the backward direction. So based on that, I made a diagnosis of rectovestibular fistula, which is a wrong terminology to be used. Vestibular fistula is to be used for the present terminology.
Okay. So when you try to introduce an infant feeding tube, it is a flexible tubing, right? So it will go in the direction where you point it at best. You cannot get it to point posteriorly, which would enable you to differentiate a rectovestibular and an inovestibular fistula. Right? So is the feeding tube a correct instrument for testing whether it is a rectovestibular or anovestibular, or do you recommend something else for that?
sir, then a 5 franc or a 6 franc red rubber tube would do the same this one, sir, or else a rice tube of 10 size can be used with a metal ending in there.
If you want to differentiate,
Hagar's dilator.
Can you use a Hagar's dilator? If you don't want to differentiate, then just get away with calling it a vestibular. Incidentally, a rectovestibular fistula intermediate anomaly. Right? And an anovestibular fistula is a low anomaly. And
is a low anomaly.
So the Krickenbeck classification is called a classification. It is actually only a list of anomalies seen in New York.
Yes.
Please understand. Krickenbeck classification. It is a list of anomalies seen in New York and Cincinnati.
Okay.
And that list is very, very small compared to the spectrum of anorectal malformations which are seen in other parts of the world, more particularly in South
America.
I will just take you to one question which Madam Sangvi had asked you earlier at this point, that which other scenario would you do a contrast enema in a female child with vestibular fistula? Because right now we are just at the investigation point.
Yes. Is it a H-type fistula? H-type fistula, sir.
See, clinical examination helps you determine whether there is an H-type or not H-type. Again, Hagar's dilator or a fine probe you can pass. It is a simple vestibular fistula, but your consultant tells you, please get a contrast done through the fistula. And you are not sure why they have asked you to do that. So can you think of any scenario?
What can you have associated?
Can there be associated which you could not discover without a contrast examination?
Sir, if that is in the case, if the vestibular is only two openings and...
There are three openings. You are correct. If there's two openings, you would like... If there are three openings, what could be there associated with the vestibular fistula?
Pouch colon?
Yeah, you can have a pouch colon.
But that's...
In a patient who has got a vestibular fistula with a pouch colon, very good answer. It's uncommon, but it can happen. And what is the distinguishing feature in such a child?
Sorry, sir?
Have you ever seen a vestibular fistula associated with a pouch colon?
No, sir, I have not seen. I have seen one associated with a cloaca, but I haven't seen a
pouch colon. The children are extremely malnourished.
Yes.
That is the single most important feature. Normal vestibular fistula, the child will rarely be malnourished and have a large picoloma in the pouch colon. So infra-umbilical mass will be present.
Okay,
go on from your diagnosis.
So based on this, sir, my initial investigation at that point of time would be, I would not prefer to do plan for surgery at this point of time, since as a child is a newborn, I would go for investigations to rule out any other associated anomalies, like any renal anomalies, urogenital anomalies, or any cardiac anomalies and spinal anomalies. For this, I will be doing an ultrasound, the kidney, urinary bladder, and kidney, ureters, and the bladder, and then ultrasound of spine, and then 2D echo for the heart anomalies to rule out the heart anomalies, which were normal. I would advise the mother for dilatation of the vestibular. Yes.
Why would you do ultrasound of the spine instead of an X-ray?
Sir, usually before the 2 months of age, we can find out any defect, sir. Since the X-ray is a radiation exposure, USG spine has got no radiation exposure, it would be better to find out any renal anomalies spinal anomalies along with any spinal cord anomalies also. They can also be.
You still have to do a single X-ray. You still have to do an X-ray AP and lateral to look for your sacrum, irrespective of the ultrasound.
And your colleagues must be doing hundreds of X-rays in 1 day, 2 day old babies in the NICU when they suspect pneumothorax and cardiac, cardiomegaly and whatnot else. So single lateral in the same place cannot expose the child to much radiation with the modern machines. And it's always better to have the surgeon can appreciate rather than a group of shadows which only radiologists can interpret, Surgeons are simple people. They like to see their picture with clear cut shapes and all, not, fuzzy blobs going around on on an ultrasound screen. Okay, so we have ruled out spinal, cardiac. What other anomalies? What total group of anomalies have you ruled out in this patient?
Sir, I've ruled out associated tracheoesophageal fistula, sir. By inserting RALS tube within the perorally or panasally, passing infant feeding tube.
And why did you need to pass a RALS tube in a non-distended abdomen? Your history has ruled out esophageal atresia.
Sorry, sir. Actually, history, they have said that they have fed the child and there was no vomiting with the child. That has ruled out the test itself. I have not put a RALS tube, sir. Actually, in the history itself, they have said that they have fed the child and child is tolerating the feeds and passing the meconium. Tolerating the feed, so I have not passed the RALS tube. So that rules out test. The gross anomalies that I couldn't find out see in this child, so no other workup is at present required.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Please, may I interrupt?
When would you like?
Only 5 minutes.
What would you like to do for this child now? When would you like to operate on this child?
Ma'am, I would like to operate this child at 3 months of age, 3 to 6 months of age, before the starting of weaning period, so that the child, when it starts to pass much more solider food, so that it can pass through a normal anal opening and not develop obstruction. So within the 3 to 6 months of age, I would like to post this child.
Also, after weaning, the stools become more solid, so the rectum dilates far more.
Yes.
You should do it by 3 months of age. What surgery would you like to do? Will you keep the child on washouts?
No, ma'am. If the patient is developing an obstruction in between, if they are coming with this one, I would like to explain to the relatives if this develops at that time to give a rectal washout. Other than that, per se, just on basis of thin dilator, SEGA dilator like 9 and 10 up to 11 is given to the parents and have explained regarding regular dilatation of the vestibular anus so that the rectum dilates and patient doesn't develop any obstruction up to the age of 3 months. And after that, I would like to plan for surgery. I'd like to plan for limited PSRP in this case.
All right. How big will your incision be?
Ma'am, it's going to be a limited PSRP. In this, the incision is going to be from the posterior vestibular fold to the neoanal opening, the posterior limit of the neoanal opening within the hyperpigmented patch which is seen in the vestibular on exam.
Or marked by
the
edges, by the muscle stimulator.
Muscle stimulator, yes.
Is there any other option to a limited PSRP?
Ma'am, ASRP is another option which can be done in this case, ma'am.
Right. When will you suspect the cloaca?
If there is a single opening which is present within the vestibule, when the patient is passing urine and along, sometimes mixed with meconium, so in that case I will be suspecting the cloaca.
And also the introitus is small in size.
Introitus is small and labia majora and minor are less developed.
Are not properly formed. Do we have any more time or are we done?
I think that's
the last few questions if you want to. Last 2 minutes, madam, if you want to ask a few questions. Otherwise, we can wrap up.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Ashish, sir. Thank you, Dr. Bijal, ma'am, for this discussion. And thank you, Dr. Amit and Dr. Himanshu. And so we now move on to the next session, which is taking forward the same atypical malformations. We have the logic complications of ARM and Hashimoto's surgery. The chairperson for this session is Dr. V. Shripathi, who is a senior pediatric urologist and robotic surgeon at Apollo Children's Hospital, Chennai, and he has been a past president of IAPSU. The speaker is Dr. Satish Agrawal, who is a consultant pediatric surgeon at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. Good afternoon, Satish Agrawal, sir. We have made you the co-host. Please share your screen.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Dr. Shripathi. So nice to see you.
Good afternoon, Satish. They couldn't have chosen a better speaker for such an important topic. Look forward to listening to you.
Thank you so much. So should I straight away share my screen and start?
Yes, sir. Please share.
Please do.
Okay. Give me a minute. So is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Absolutely.
Right. Okay. So right at the outset, I must express my gratitude to Pradhana and the entire team for giving me this opportunity. And thank you, Dr. Shripathi, for agreeing to chair this session, very important session, of course. And let me start with this paper, BJU International in 1999. I think this is a very good paper and every president must read it. And it talks about the association of anorectal malformations with the genitourinary system. It's not only urinary, it is genitourinary system. So we follow a ARGUS protocol, anorectal, genitourinary, and sacral. Dr. Ashish Vaghlu pulled this candidate so nicely when he didn't mention about sacral anomaly. It's a very important component of any anorectal malformation, be it male or female. So we all know that associated anomalies are very common in anorectal malformations, of which genitourinary accounts for the most common, as much as 60%, and followed by vertebral anomalies. So of the genitourinary anomalies, we know that VUR is almost associated in 50% of cases, and other anomalies also not that uncommon. I would like to draw your attention to the last one enlisted here, the duplications of urinary tract, which are quite forgotten and very often unrecognized. And I have two cases which illustrate how important this anomaly can be when we deal with anorectal malformation. I hope my voice is clear.
Yes.
Okay. So let's start screening for the sacral anomalies. And as Ashish said, obtain a plain film. We always do a plain film of the abdomen in any child born with anorectal malformations for several reasons. One, we want to know the gas pattern. Second, we want to know if there is a pouch colon associated, because pouch is quite a common finding in our part of the world. And then very often a baby gram is done. And if that is so, then you have to count the number of vertebrae. And mind you, within the first 24 hours, if you do an AP film, you can better appreciate the sacral vertebrae because the gas has not descended down into the pelvis because of the ARM itself. And therefore, the sacral vertebrae will be better visible. Now, you must differentiate between sacral dysplasia and agenesis. Dysplasia means a disorder of alignment or symmetry, while agenesis means a true bony defect where the number of vertebrae are less than the optimal. Then the next investigation for screening is an ultrasound spine, which is needed only if the X-ray shows some abnormality. And ultrasound of the spine can give a good information on the spinal cord because the arch is unossified in children almost up to 1 year of age. MRI is very rarely essential, and it's indicated when either there is a spinal cord anomaly, spinal vertebral anomaly, or there is some neurological problem. Now this is showing a typical segmentation abnormality in the sacrum and the X-ray taken first within 24 hours. And when you take a prone cross table lateral view, you can quite clearly see normal sacral vertebrae here, and therefore this child does not need any further investigation as far as sacrum is concerned. Now, renal ultrasound is a very important investigation, and you must stress on the ultrasonologist that he must look for ureters, whether the ureter is dilated or not, bladder neck, whether the bladder is emptying well or not, and if there is an upper tract dilatation. If there is a ureteric dilatation in a child, then you can almost certainly say it is because of reflux, unless proved otherwise. Of course, cloaca is an exception where ureteric dilatation can mean a hydrocal pause. And then VCUG is an investigation which all children with upper tract dilatation should undergo. And in a male child, when you are doing a distal cologram, it should also be combined with MCUG. And I'll illustrate this in a little while. And when we talk of reflux, it's not only vesicoureteric reflux, it's also urethrovasal reflux and reflux into the seminal vesicles. It's uncommon, but not unheard of. The next component of urinary tract is the lower urinary tract symptoms, usually obstructive symptoms, dribbling, voiding dysfunction, etc. Now, as much as 25% of anorectal malformation kids will have it. Now, it's of two types. Primary lower urinary tract dysfunction occurs only if there is a sacral anomaly. But secondary has several causes. It can occur because of the surgery itself, especially in children with rectourethral fistula and sacral anomaly, a cloaca repair, or a combined abdominal and posterior sagittal repair, say for example in a child with rectovesical fistula, and when you are doing surgery for pouch colon, because you have to dissect behind the bladder and you may cause injury because of the surgery itself. Now, everyone knows that anorectal malformation is a wide spectrum of disease. You can have a rectovesical fistula, rectoprostatic fistula, and most common rectobulbar urethral fistula, and then low anomalies like perineal fistula. Similarly, in females, we know that this is the most common defect, the vestibular fistula. Now, why did I put up this slide? I put up this slide to show you a very simple anatomical fact in anorectal malformation, which, if you keep in mind, you will prevent a lot of damage to the urinary tract and the genital tract. So, in boys, if you look at this piece of the anatomy, there is a common wall between the urinary tract and the hindgut, just before the hindgut opens into the urinary tract. And this is the most important bit of the anatomy, apart from staying in the midline. If you stay in the submucosal plane from within the rectum, so that the rectal wall, rectal muscle, is not disturbed from the posterior wall of the prostatic urethra and whatever of the membranous and bulbar urethra is there, then you'll be safe. And therefore, you must understand that the submucosal dissection into the rectum must go on till you reach a completely separate plane between the muscle of the urinary tract and muscle of the rectum. And this dissection will be quite a long dissection when you're dealing with a rectobulbar fistula. And it will be shorter if you're dealing with a rectoprostatic fistula. Similarly, in females, the difference is that in between the urinary and the hindgut, there is vagina. And so there is a common wall between the vagina and the rectum. And here you have to be careful in this plane. Although when we talk of dissection from the vagina, we generally say that do not injure the rectum. You can injure the vagina because you can repair the vagina, but you can't afford to lose the rectum. But remember, and I'll illustrate with one case. There are Is it okay?
Yes, sir, please go ahead.
Right, okay. So now this is a normal happening when normally vagina is there. Remember, there are some cases where vagina is absent. So vaginal agenesis with an anorectal malformation can often be misdiagnosed as vestibular fistula. And I have a case to illustrate how an absent vagina was not picked up, and so the dissection was carried between the urethra and the rectum because there was no vagina, and that led to injury in the urethra and the bladder neck. So it's very important to decipher the anatomy before you proceed. Another common situation in the northern India, pouch colon. And I always insist, in a newborn child with anorectal malformation, not only the prone cross-table lateral film, I also insist on an AP film which can show a beautiful pouch colon like this. And they usually have meconiuria. Even if their perineums are reasonably okay, they will have meconiuria. And they will have abdominal distension like this. And when you open them up, you'll find a large pouch. This is a type 1 pouch just leading from the ileocecal junction. Now, let's talk about the urological complications or injuries. Now, most of the complications will be either technique related or because of an unrecognized anatomy. And I'll again and again emphasize on the importance of anatomy. Then a urethral diverticulum, which is a very frequent complication after the era of laparoscopic pull-through, has started in anorectal malformations. And that's because of wrong selection of a bulbar fistula for a laparoscopic pull-through. And that leaves a large part of hindgut still attached to the urethra, which leads to a big diverticulum, which can cause a host of problems, infections, stone, pyuria, and things like that. Recurrent fistula is also a complication. Ureteric injuries, not to forget, especially if you're dealing with dilated ureters, low-lying ureters, ectopic ureters, and vesicoureteric reflux. And on top of that, if you have a difficult PSARP or a redo PSARP, then ureteric injuries is a very real possibility. And then there can be disastrous complications. I've had the opportunity to redo a case who had his bladder pulled down as rectum and ureter divided as a fistula. That's of course a very bizarre complication. It doesn't happen normally, but it can happen, and it has been published also. Now let's do some illustrative cases. This is an unrecognized anatomy of urethral and rectal duplication, but unrecognized only till the preoperative period. During the operation, we suspected it and therefore proceeded with care, and we were able to avoid an injury. But this is the perfect case where if you have not worked for your anatomical details, then you are almost likely to injure the urinary tract. So this is a newborn, and if you notice that he has a almost an intermediate like anomaly, the rectal gas has descended fairly down from the sacrum, and one would in fact think, why not do a primary pull through in this child? But then look at this anatomy. He's got a flattish bottom, not a typical intermediate variety. And look at this median rafe, which is deviated. That's the meatus, and median rafe is deviating. So something was amiss in this child. And there was no pouch colon on this plain film. So we did a colostomy, of course, in the newborn period. And then this is the MCUG. If you look at the MCUG, he's got a vesicoureteric reflux, and incidentally, he had renal agenesis on the other side. So reflux there, and look at this posterior urethra. It's going like a diverticulum posteriorly. The rest of the urethra is normal. And here you can, this is not a very good picture, but this was not demonstrating a very good rectourethral fistula. Probably either because the pressure was low, or because of some other reason, or because the fistula was very narrow or blocked by mucus, we don't know, but it wasn't showing very well. Now with this information, this is my policy. In 90% of cases of anorectal malformations in boys, I do a cystoscopy just before putting the patient in prone jackknife position. And this is what we found in this child. So that's the sphincter-active urethra. And as we go in, that's a diverticulum on the left side of the posterior urethra, just by the side of the viru. That's the bladder neck there. And as we injected some dye from the distal limb of the colon, the colostomy, you see this tiny opening and this streak of betadine flowing. This betadine is coming from the distal segment of the colostomy. So a urethral diverticulum and a fistula just below that. And if you go back to the MCUG, this diverticulum is corresponding with what we saw on the endoscopy here. So we knew that there is something in the posterior urethra immediately above the rectourethral fistula. So in a nutshell, this is what we found. So this child had hind gut ending in a tiny fistula there, and then a duplication of the rectum opening through another fistula. And this fistula was actually showing as a diverticulum on the MCUG. But this hind gut was showing as a diverticulum from the urinary tract. The rectal duplication from posterior sagittal approach, this is the rectum identified, and this is the duplication. And this is the duplication just opened up, and that's the fistula going to the urinary tract. And this is the hindgut epithelium in the duplication. And the duplication and the rectum had a common wall. So what we did was take this mucosa out, close the fistula there, leave this muscle behind, and pull down the rectum. So lesson learned from this case is probably cystoscopy is the best way to study the fistula. And very often we get patients who've done a distal cologram from outside, and the fistula is not showing properly, either because they have not done washes properly or because it is blocked. So if I get an information from the distal cologram that the length of the distal colon is off, and then I assess the perineal anatomy, then I do a cystoscopy. I don't go for a repeat distal cologram, just go for a cystoscopy, and it has helped me very much. And remember to do MCUG and colon both in such cases. And if unusual features are there, then MRI may be considered. In this child, we could have, in retrospect, thought of doing an MR before proceeding. No substitute for good decision and respect for tissue planes. And always know the anatomy before you proceed. Now, this is a child with unrecognized anatomy of vaginal agenesis. Now, this is a 12-year-old girl child who at 1 year of age had an anovestibular fistula surgery. And at 12, she presented with constipation. And on deep questioning, when I noticed on examination that her underpants were a little wet, just a little wet, I inquired, does it always happen? And she says, yes, few drops of urine come out through the day. And she had amenorrhea. So what we found, the diagnosis of anovestibular fistula was wrong in this child because there was no vagina. So the dissection that the surgeon did was between the rectum and the urethra, and he probably caused some injury to the urethra and bladder neck, which then resulted in a communication through a small, tiny sieve-like openings into the vulva that led to only few drops of urine coming out, which were very irrelevant to the patient. She never complained. It's just that examination, I saw some wet patch on her underpants and I inquired. And when we did the cystoscopy, everything was clear. So this child, we then did a vaginal replacement with a Monty segment of gut and placed a momentum there, which healed her injury and repaired the vagina, and then she was fine. So anatomy is very important before you proceed. Now this is a child with Hirschsprung's disease and anorectal malformation. An anorectal malformation, in fact, was missed in this child in the first go. How? I'll let you know just now. So this is a patient who was diagnosed as Hirschsprung's disease in neonatal period, but his anal orifice was reportedly normal. So he underwent a primary lap-assisted transanal pull-through at few weeks of age, and before that he was put on washouts. He developed anal stenosis, which was dilated, and after some weeks, a recto-urethral fistula was noticed, and therefore a colostomy was done. Then a redo pull-through was done, where a long segment disease was recognized, so some more colon was excised, and the fistula was repaired. And then the colostomy was closed. And after the colostomy was closed, the child again passed urine through the rectum. So there was a recurrent recto-urethral fistula. And then he was referred to me. So what did I find? On cystoscopy, just by the side of the viru, there was a big hole in the urethra, which communicated with the rectum. But there were several tracts going towards the rectum, not single tract, so I couldn't pass a guide wire. But there was no need because he was passing urine through his rectum. And look at this, this was his perineum. It doesn't look like a normal perineum. So what he had was actually a funnel anus syndrome, a very rare anorectal malformation, which is kind of a perineal mound defect, where for a long distance, the anal canal travels like a cave, and that leads to the normal rectum higher up. So this was missed during his initial surgery, which we deciphered that he had anorectal malformation as well as Hirschsprung's disease. And that is when we proceeded to do an MRI. An MRI showed almost a complete absence of sphincter muscles. So we were able to prognosticate this patient that his continence levels will not be good because he has no sphincter muscles. And also, it gave us a good anatomical picture of the anal canal of funnel anus and everything. So what we did to this child is, through a posterior sagittal and abdominal approach, we identified this. This is the child in prone jackknife position, midline incision. So this cannula is placed into the recto-urethral fistula. So this is the fibrous tissue behind the prostate. That's where the fistula was. And the actual rectal lining was above this. And for that, we had to enter the abdomen to mobilize it. All the rest distally was just a skin tube, very thin stenotic skin tube. So this is the intra-abdominal exploration, terminal ileum, cecum, and only this much of colon was there. Because he had a diagnosis of long segment, so the entire colon had been resected. So only this much colon was available. Down into the perineum, really had to mobilize the iliopolic pedicle, bring the cecum down, and then this either colic pedicle could come down into the perineum for a successful, without tension, rectal pull-through. And this is what we achieved. A wide skin to mucosa anastomosis after closing the fistula. So what do we learn from this child is that the urethra is always at risk during a transanal pull-through. And if the patient is a smaller child, then be very careful when you are doing a submucosal dissection on the anterior wall of the rectum. That's where the urethra gets injured. It's not very difficult to injure the urethra unless you're careful. So you have to do an extreme caution while doing the submucosal dissection, especially anteriorly. And one good trick is that you must feel the catheter always while dissecting anteriorly. And remember, it can slip out during change in position. And I'll illustrate a case which happened in my hands. Just now, I'll tell you about this case where the catheters slipped out, and we thought that the catheter is in, kept on feeling for it, didn't feel it, so we thought the dissection is okay, and we transected the urethra. So this is the child. This is a down baby, and we've done a lap-assisted pull-through. Laparoscopic part has been done. So this is the beginning of the transanal part. So while doing the anterior dissection, without my realization, the catheter was out. And so I dissected anteriorly, unless I saw urine coming. And to my horror, I recognized that I had completely transected the urethra. Now, because it happened on the table, and I have an experience in repairing urethral injuries, so you can notice this perineal incision here. In the same sitting, we did a perineal anastomotic end-to-end anastomosis of the urethra because they recognized it on the table. If it goes unrecognized, or if the dissection proceeds just behind the urethra, it can even cause ischemic injury to the urethra. And I've had a case where the ischemic injury resulted in a long stricture of the urethra following a Hirschsprung's disease operation. So the bottom line is anterior dissection in lap-assisted transanal pull-through or transanal pull-through without lap assistance, the anterior dissection is very, very important, and you should be very careful while doing it. So this is an illustration, a very simple illustration, which shows where a bulbar fistula was approached laparoscopically. You can see this is the diverticulum in the posterior urethra because of a long fistula left behind with the urinary tract. And this is exposure through the posterior sagittal root. The rectum has been dissected. And this is the wide diverticulum with colonic lining. And this is actually the site of fistula. So all this was excised, fistula was closed, rectum was placed back in the middle of the sphincters, and he was fine. Now, how to avoid this? And avoid which case to select for laparoscopy, which case not to select for laparoscopy. If you do a cystoscopy and find fistula above the veru, then you can go for laparoscopy. If it is below the veru like this, then I do a PSARP. Do not venture into laparoscopy. Please stop me whenever time finishes or if you want to discuss, I can stop here. There are several other illustrative cases, but I made my point that knowledge of anatomy and deciphering the anatomy well during the surgery, either it be cystoscopy or very carefully crafted dye studies, unless you have all the information, you should not proceed with surgery for anal rectal malformations.
Dr. Satish,
yes.
Your point about the LUTS, I thought that slide was extremely important. I just wanted you to reinforce to the audience why it is, for instance, there was a question in the chat group as to why MCU is important.
Right.
Now the MCU, I've had situations where people have had secondary procedures on the bladder done later, and the bladder has been a neurogenic bladder, and
yes,
people have come to the verge of filing a case against the doctor who did the secondary procedure. Now, in these sort of cases, they have not documented the bladder at the time of the original pull-through. My question to you is, how important is it to do it? And should you add Guru Dynamics to this as well in order to avoid these sort of problems later?
Right, okay. So, a very pertinent issue, very pertinent issue. Every day we see complications, every day we see patients where urinary tract symptoms are picked up late. And when these children grow to become the school-going children, then the parents bring them. And the history, typical history is he had had an operation for aneurysmal malformation. So how to pick these anomalies first? As I mentioned, lower urinary tract symptoms can be primary if there are sacral anomalies. So if there is a sacral anomaly, your fate is written from there. If there is a sacral anomaly, you can expect a bladder dysfunction. And therefore, urodynamics in these children should be done as early as possible and as early as feasible in your protocol. I don't do it in very young children, but yes, people have done it even at 1 month of age. And that's a very good tool to document for sure that your baby is going to suffer from urinary tract dysfunction, and he may be a candidate for CIC right from the beginning if you want to avoid upper tract damage or even bladder damage. That's point number one. Now, if the sacrum had been recorded normal, as far as the bones are concerned, then it's very unlikely that the child will have a spinal cord problem. So spinal cord problems will occur only if there are vertebral bodies anomalies, or if there is an abnormal ultrasound of the sacral spine, in which case you would have done MR spine in any case. And if you document a normal spine on an MRI, then whatever damage is there in the urethra is secondary. Or because of your dissection in a difficult anatomy. Difficult anatomy means you have to dissect behind the bladder, like rectovesical fistula. You have to you have to do a cloaca repair, where even if the spine is normal, you know that the incidence of lower urinary tract dysfunction is quite high, purely because of the urogenital sinus, or when you're doing a combined abdominal and PSARP, or when you're doing a pouch colon. So in these situations, you can expect a degree of bladder dysfunction, and therefore you should be very careful in following these children up with whatever tool you have. MCUG is very good for any aneurysmal malformation. I always do MCUG and distal colostomy simultaneously for boys, because we know that 50% of boys will have vesicoureteric reflux. And that's another reason why I go for a cystoscopy to begin with in these children, because cystoscopy gives me a lot of other information about the ureteric orifices, diverticulae, posterior urethra, bladder neck, anterior urethra, several features I study on a cystoscopy. I think that's what you would expect, Dr. Sripathi.
Yeah, absolutely. You put it across wonderfully. The other thing I wanted a confirmation from you, that's a general feeling that a rectovestibular fistula is an easy anomaly to operate. But I'm finding a lot of urological problems later on in these sort of children. Am I right in that? You must have a vast experience with that.
Well, cloacas, yes. But
yes.
Rectourethral, you mean?
Rectovestibular fistula. In female children.
Well,
yes.
In female children,
yeah.
Universal experience is, for either it's anovestibular or rectovestibular,
yes.
Constipation is a very significant problem, which is a functional constipation.
Okay.
Because of motility disturbance, one, and two, because of rectal ectasia.
Yes.
And in fact, my policy is, if the child has come to me at newborn period, I will put them on some form of dilatations for a few weeks and then do a primary repair before the rectum gets a chance to distend. If the rectum has distended already, then I do not do a primary. I will do a colostomy and then repair. And then I'll put them on a very good dilatation program, and I'll follow them up very carefully to avoid constipation.
Yes.
I have seen that most of the urinary tract dysfunction is secondary to constipation in these children, which is overlooked. But
Dr. Bhatti has asked a question. What is the incidence of urogenic bladder after pull-through, in your experience?
Well, that's a difficult question to answer. I can't tell you the incidence, but it is not uncommon. it is not uncommon, not uncommon.
Okay.
Especially as I mentioned, all these things, all four or five of these categories.
Correct.
And when there is a sacral anomaly, neurogenic dysfunction is common.
One last question. There have been a lot of questions in the chat group about the role of MRI. Could you reinforce to us for when exactly would you do an MRI in these children?
Well, there are two MRIs that we are talking about here. One is an MRI spine, and the second is MRI of the pelvis, looking for the muscles.
Okay.
Now, if I am dealing with a complication in any child, male or female, and I have to do a redo pull through, I will always do an MRI of the pelvis and the perineum to look for the anatomy that I'm going to handle. Because that's not a normal anatomy. And that's not an anatomy which has been given to us by embryology. It's an iatrogenic anatomy, and I need to study it. Also for the importance of prognostication. So the example that I gave, the child with Hirschsprung's with anorectal malformations.
Correct.
If I hadn't done an MRI, the child was continent. And after my repair, he was going to become 100% incontinent. So I had a tool to explain to them, look, there are no muscles. So that's one point. Second, MRI will help you in telling you how much is the rectal ectasia proximal. You can tell that by a dye study also, but MRI is one study which combines everything together. And when we do MRI for such children, there are several things that we do. Our protocol is different. We will put some saline or jelly. Xylocaine jelly is a very good contrast for MRI.
Excellent.
If you fill the jelly into the rectum, it will tell you the complete anatomy of the rectum. If you fill the bladder with saline, it will tell you completely the anatomy of the urethra. That child with Hirschsprung's disease who had recurrent fistula several times, operated several times, came from Northeast. And MRI told us everything that I deciphered on the cystoscopy, MRI had already given me the information about. So that's MRI of the perineum and pelvis to know the anatomy. MR spine I'll do if I found a vertebral anomaly in the sacrum or anywhere else. So if I do a babygram and I find some vertebral anomalies in the thoracic vertebra or in the lumbar vertebrae, then I will do an MR spine. If I find an abnormality on ultrasound of the spine, if there is any reason to suspect a tethered cord, I would do an MR spine. If I'm getting a child with neurogenic dysfunction of the bladder, either primary or secondary, and I don't know what's the cause, to complete the workup, I'll get an MR spine, just to be sure that we're not dealing with a cause in the spine, in the spinal cord. Satish,
excellent, wonderful discussion. You have illustrated all the points very clearly, and you have answered everything point by point. I think for a student going for the exam, you can't have a better discussion than this.
Yes, fully agree with you, and thank you, Dr.
Thank you
for sharing this session, and thank you so much, Dr. Satish Agrawal sir, for this excellent presentation.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. So we move on to the next session, which is role of interventional radiology in pediatric surgery. The speakers for this session are Dr. Suyash Kulkarni, who is the head of the Department of Interventional Radiology at Tata Medical Hospital, Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Bhavesh Popat, consultant interventional radiology at Tata Memorial Hospital. Dr. Nitin Shetty, who is also a consultant interventional radiologist at Tata Memorial Hospital, and Dr. Girish Varvadekar, who is a consultant interventional radiologist at Leelavati and several leading hospitals in Mumbai. Dr. Suresh Kulkarni sir, we have made you the co-host. Please share your screen. Dr. Kulkarni sir, please unmute yourself and share your screen.
Sorry.
sir, you are not audible. Please unmute yourself. Sir, you are not connected to audio. So we can see your screen, but we are not able to hear you. Sir Kulkarni, sir, we are not able to hear you. We can see your screen. You will have to connect your device to audio. Sir, Kulkarni sir, please unmute yourself. शेट्टी गिरीश सर कोई तो कुछ बोलो, उनका दिख रहा है कि वो बोल रहे हैं क्या? I request all the participants to please bear with us. There is some technical problem, and I think this is for the first time that we are doing this on Zoom, so some technical problems were expected, and I think this is the time for the technical problems. Please do continue with us while we sort the problem out.
Meanwhile, Dr. Rajkishore Bagadi is in the audience. If he can throw some light while we are waiting for the technical glitches to be sorted out, if I am audible.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
So can we invite Dr. Rajkishore Bagadi to speak? If you can make him co-host and he can unmute himself.
Yeah.
Because he has put a very pertinent question in the chat box. And he's probably the most experienced pediatric surgeon amongst the audience right now.
Sure. While the problem gets fixed, we can surely do that.
Hello, Dr. Yes. Tish. How are you?
Good morning, Dr. Bhavde. Good afternoon, sir. How are you?
Your presentation was very good, as usual. I've known you for so many years.
We learn from your experience. You are probably most experienced.
You're talking about neurological problem. As you were wondering when tubular structure was coming, I was wondering what, I was trying to break my head, I was wondering what is not the rectum. The rectum was very high, then I thought with the bladder, with the ureter. It took quite a long time for me to realize what it is. Then I realized the child had an undescended testis too.
All right.
That structure, the rectum was ending high up, and that was a Mullerian remnant, you know.
Oh my God.
So I turned the patient around and then realized, pre laparoscopy. That was the thing which is not described anywhere at all, any of the books. Then personally, I found a lot of neurogenic bladder happens after all these pull-throughs. I don't know, but you get a lot of complicated cases operated by others. The thing is, whether it's a PSAR or whether even it's after this thing, pull-throughs for the ASR, you know, the incidence of neurogenic bladder is unreported. The parents, no, they complain of dribbling of urine. They say, ye to pehle takleef tha hi nahi. You know, they're happy on. Rather than the rectal problem, the dribbling of urine bothers them more.
Satish, if I can just sort of, you know, just elaborate on this point by Dr. Bhagdi.
Yes.
Right now, I have a child who's to go for a renal transplant. Had an anorectal anomaly repaired at birth and has subsequently had a re-implant done for reflux. Right. And the bladder is neurogenic, and the child is an end-stage renal disease with a calculated creatinine clearance of 19. So the question that they often ask is the same question. Was this a problem that the bladder had before when the first surgery started, or was this caused by the surgery? Exactly what Dr. Rajkishore Bhagdi is asking. The second point why I thought your talk was so important was, I don't have the sort of humongous experience that you have in dealing with some of these complicated problems. I saw an anorectal anomaly pull through done in which the bladder neck and the urethra had been cut at two levels and repaired.
At two levels.
And it was horrendous. And the child was just not able to void. The thing that I could do was just an SPC and send it to someone who could handle it. But what I'm trying to say is the complications, the urological complications after anorectal anomaly and Hirschsprung's disease surgery are so important that it warrants a separate webinar and a discussion by itself.
I fully agree with you. In fact, when Dr. Padna Bendre asked me to speak on some topic, I said, look, I've got some experience with this kind of problems and this will be new. And so she immediately agreed that, yes, you speak on urological complications. There are several other cases because this was only limited to 20 minutes talk.
No, you remember Dr. Shripati?
Yes, sir. Go ahead, Satish.
Dr. Shripati, you remember I remember speaking with the child, you know, like, you know?
Yeah.
Actually, the child is doing well, but I felt very bad, you know, after the anorectal and had neurogenic bladder, and then you did CIC, you know, that went to do family. They are grateful, actually. Some of the child returned to normal. I was wondering if the child is going to have neurogenic bladder all its life. The child is all right now, actually.
That emphasizes the importance of what Satish has spoken about, evaluation of the spine and the pelvis. Yeah.
And Dr. Shripati, you would also remember 2014, we did a workshop in Bangalore, Ramesh Kumar did it.
Yeah.
Yes, Ramesh. Yeah. And I operated on that child who had an anorectal malformation operated elsewhere. And then several other surgeries, and I was given to repair his urethral stricture. And if you remember, I did it on the day prior to this surgery workshop because it was going to take almost 12 hours.
I remember that.
I presented a synopsis on the next day.
Correct.
And that child had anorectal malformation with such a severe problems with the genitourinary tract. He had a urethral duplication, which was aborted. He had a seminal vesicle cyst and he had several pits in the posterior urethra.
Yeah, I remember that. Sanjay Kulkarni was amazed at the complexity of the case. I remember that.
And in fact, that urethral duplication, Ramesh kept on telling me, why don't you anastomose with this? I said, no, this is not looking normal. So let me go ahead.
and then went on doing resection of the seminal vesicle cyst. So as Dr. Bagdi pointed out, the tubular structure, and you don't know what it is, it could be these genital remnants, this could be seminal vesicle, they're all dysplastic structures. After all, this is an embryological insult, and there is no limit to embryological insults in such cases. So I think anatomy must be deciphered. And there are several cases where I can show urethrovasal reflux. In fact, children have lost their testes because of epididymorchitis, recurrent epididymorchitis. They have even required vasectomy to save their testes.
No, this raises a very important point. Oh, sorry, Dr. Suyash is starting now.
Right, yep. Fine.
It just raises the point that we perhaps, as an association, we need centers of excellence like yours, Satish, and I'm sure many more centers across the country, where these complicated problems are handled in the best of hands, rather than each person trying to do something and making a bad problem worse. This is my personal opinion. I don't know whether people will agree with me, but sometimes when you see the misery of these children, it is unbelievable.
100% agree with you. I'm sure Dr. Bagdi will agree 100%.
With us. Are you able to hear me through the mobile now?
Yes.
Yes, sir, we are able to hear you. Please go ahead.
Okay, I will start. So, sorry for the technical glitches. At the outset, I would like to thank the whole Wadia faculty and Wadia and Tata Hospital administration to, you know, have this collaboration with Wadia Hospital and Tata Memorial Hospital to provide the interventional radiology services at Wadia Hospital. And in turn, we have many students here in MD Radiology and DM Interventional Radiology at Tata Hospital who get an opportunity to get an exposure and learn the pediatric interventional radiology. So to start, we initially thought of presenting the cases, but then I thought that we'll give the overall role of interventional radiology, the scope of interventional radiology in pediatric oncology. We have a team of interventional radiologists at Tata Hospital. We have 5 faculty and around 12 fellows. And Dr. Bhavesh Popat is the consultant associate professor with us who leads the team at Wadia Hospital for Interventional Radiology. So Dr. Girish Varavadekar and Dr. Bhavesh, right now both of them are doing cases at different places. So I thought I will present the overall scope of interventional radiology in pediatric oncology. So I am audible, right?
We can hear you. We can hear you.
Okay. So basically, interventional radiology is mean to intervene in a minimally invasive way to carry out the procedures precisely under the appropriate image guidance. This is a typical prototype of an interventional radiologist who is always ready to intervene. Sometimes people call us interfering radiologists, but probably in the next 40 minutes, I will try to convince that we are not interfering, but interventional radiologists. So this is a typical setup of digital subtraction angiography cath lab where we do most of our procedures. And now we have a state-of-the-art cath lab at Wadia Hospital, and it is a pleasure to work there, especially for the pediatric interventional radiological procedures. So we do diagnostic as well as therapeutic procedures. Among diagnostic spectrum, we essentially do various biopsies, which are critical or high risk, or the high risk of bleeding especially, and pediatric population where we usually do it under anesthesia. So we should not repeat the procedures, and sometimes through the vascular access like transjugular liver biopsies.
So we always do the biopsies with a coaxial system so that we can take adequate and multiple cores. Various types of true cut biopsy needles are available, the cord needles are available. So ultimately the aim is to get a good representative sample like this so that we get a definite diagnosis. Some examples like this small child has a
are you sharing internet with both the devices? I mean, if you are, then maybe you can switch off the
video. Okay, now it is okay. Am I audible now?
You're audible. If the internet connectivity is an issue, you can maybe switch off your video. That will facilitate the.
I'm not sharing.
Okay.
Yeah, I have switched off the video on my mobile.
Yeah.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, sir. We can.
Hello.
Yeah.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Should I continue? Hello?
Yes.
Should I continue?
You can continue, sir. Now you are loud and clear. In between, the voice is getting blurred and we can't hear you properly.
Okay. Probably today, somehow I'm not knowing what to do, but if at all you can hear me, then I'll continue. Otherwise, I will stop. You can tell me like that. Oh, okay, so I'll just continue some of the critically placed biopsies, like this, and which we need to target, we do it under CT scan guidance. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so sometimes we need to do the biopsies under through transjugular access, that we go through jugular vein and take biopsies from the liver, usually for the liver parenchymal diseases where the coagulation profile is deranged and patient can bleed. In such cases, the biopsy is done through the transjugular route. So such kind of diagnostic procedures we do under interventional radiology. And under the therapeutic procedure spectrum, we do various non-vascular and vascular work.
under the work essentially is like a plumber, you know, like we either block the bleeding vessels or ducts, or we open the vessels which are blocked. So we are essentially doing a job of a plumber, where most of the common procedures that we do are the drainage procedures, like picture insertions, the biliary obstructions which we drain through PTBDs, the urological obstructions, and the one more major spectrum in oncology is the percutaneous ablations of the tumor. So these are typical pictal catheters that we use for various deeply seated collections, which otherwise can affect the outcome of a front, beautifully done surgery. So an example of an obstructed urological system, like we drain the kidney through pigtails with percutaneous nephrostomies, and then bypass the obstruction through a DJ stent. An example of a big mass causing hydronephrosis and hydroureter, we drain the system and also put the DJ stents to relieve the obstruction. In the hepatobiliary system, again, we do vascular and non-vascular procedures. Among the non-vascular, we usually relieve the obstructions of obstructed biliary system. For example, this poorly differentiated neuroblastoma, the child presented with progressively increasing jaundice. We drain such biliary obstructions through percutaneous biliary drainage, bypass the obstruction, and get the physiological drainage into the system. Sometimes we come across patients with post-op leaks across the anastomosis. In such cases, we drain the system as well as we put cover stent across so as to take care of the leak. I hope I am audible.
Yes, you are audible, sir. Please go.
Yeah. So one more example of a rhabdomyosarcoma involving the common biliary duct, where a patient presented with jaundice, and in rhabdomyosarcoma, we drain the system as well as through the biliary system, we give intra-biliary brachytherapy so as to take care of the tumor and relieve the obstruction. Coming to a spectrum of ablative therapies, that is radio frequency ablation, cryo ablation, microwave ablations, we do these procedures so as to literally cook the tumors or freeze the tumors so that a major surgery can be avoided. In principle, radio frequency ablation is the most established ablative modality, where we insert an electrode into the tumor and a very high frequency current is passed. It creates thermal energy, and that causes coagulative necrosis of the tumor. So this is essentially the generator of radio frequency ablation, and these are the electrodes that we use for radio frequency ablation of the tumor. This is a bipolar electrode which works like a bipolar cautery. And this is the zone of ablation you can appreciate, after which is causing for example, this is a margin which mimics the surgical margin, and rather than making a major surgery, we can just percutaneously operate the ablative tumor. So some examples of rare lesions like fibromatosis, which are notorious to get recurred after multiple surgeries, they can be again tackled by a small percutaneous CT guided procedure, where the electrode is inserted and the whole lesion is ablated. So the repetitive surgeries can be avoided for such patients. Again, lesions, benign lesions like chondroblastomas, osteomas, which are near the growth plate. In such cases, the surgery might be a little morbid. The uptake that is shown on a nuclear scan ablated, and that is the treatment for such lesions. And after ablation, it is completely taken care of. The pain is completely cured. So this is now the standard of care for such benign lesions.
Thank you, sir.
coming to various vascular procedures, we essentially do the embolizations to like braces and to create certain shunts. Pre-operative setting, like when the mass is very vascular, we need to decrease the vascularity of the tumor so that the surgeon can get a clean field. Or when patients are having inadvertent bleeding from GI tract or bronchial artery, in such cases or post-operative blowouts, we treat them with embolizations. So essentially the GI bleeds, the hemoptysis, where we do bronchial artery embolization, hematemesis is managed with tips in portal hypertension. The post-traumatic bleeds, post-surgical bleeds and intracranial bleeds can be managed with minimally invasive access through interventional radiological techniques. One example of a patient presenting with hematemesis, there was a pseudoaneurysm, you can see, of gastroduodenal artery, which can be easily tackled by coiling that particular pseudoaneurysm and blocking the artery. So practically, in any vessel in the body, we can reach through various types of catheters and microcatheters, which can be navigated to any intracranial vessel or peripheral vascular system. So we do tumor embolizations in CNS, especially like when the tumors are so vascular and involving the carotid territory, it is these tumors bleed a lot during surgery. In such cases, we do an angiography. You can see that there is a lot of vascularity which after embolization gets completely devascularized, and the surgeon can operate the tumor and do an R0 resection. One example of a patient who completely treated case of leukemia, she presented with ophthalmoplegia and substantial epistaxis. She had fungal pneumonitis. You can see that this is all fungal aspergillosis. We used to get these patients more when we had construction activity going on in our hospital. And you can see that there is invasive fungal sinusitis involving the cavernous sinus, the maxillary sinus, and this patient was having epistaxis because of the pseudoaneurysm and destruction of the cavernous part of the ICA, from which she was getting epistaxis as well as causing ophthalmoplegia. The treatment is simple. We do an angiography through the carotid artery, block that particular pseudoaneurysm, and sometimes block the artery. We always test whether the cross circulation is adequate, and that particular pseudoaneurysm can be occluded. The patient completely recovered, the ophthalmoplegia completely recovered, and the epistaxis was taken care of. Am I audible now?
So your audio is not very clear, sir, now.
Hello.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Now am I audible?
Yes.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, sir.
This patient has, yeah. So this so 5-year-old child, she had extensive fungal pneumonia and presented with hemoptysis. Am I audible?
You are audible.
So, yeah, so we did a bronchial artery embolization. You can see the blush over here, which was the cause of her hemoptysis. And after embolization of the bronchial artery, the hemoptysis was taken care of. Similarly, this patient of lymphoma leukemia, who was under remission, presented with massive hematemesis. And you can see that there was a pseudoaneurysm of the subclavian. Because of the post-radiation, there was a blowout of the subclavian artery, which can be easily treated by just placing a covered stent across. So such a radiological technique. One more child, she presented with hematemesis, and you can see that there is an infection which is causing mycotic aneurysm of the aorta. Such aortic aneurysms can be treated by placing a covered stent graft through the femoral axis. In this patient, if you see the aortogram, there is an aneurysm which is a mycotic aneurysm, and this is the stent graft which is kept or deployed across the aneurysm, and the aneurysm is treated. Patient was treated of the hematemesis. we do certain visceral angiographies, like for example for liver, we do chemoembolizations for the hepatic masses, where we essentially go selectively into the vascular supply of the tumor and inject the chemotherapeutic drug, as well as we block the supply of blood supply of the tumor, so that over a period of time it shrinks. Especially in pediatric population, we do it for hepatoblastomas. You can see a large hepatoblastoma, which with through selective transarterial chemoembolization is done. This is the blush of the vascular blush of the hepatoblastoma, which has been treated with chemoembolization. You can see that there is significant reduction in the size of the hepatoblastoma, and we also did portal embolization, and this particular patient was operated. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
You're audible. Yes, sir. Please.
Okay. So certain venous access, central venous access, can be taken through the under ultrasound guidance and fluoro guidance, especially the PICC catheters and ports. The chemo ports, they are put under image guidance precisely, so that the migration of the ports can be avoided. At the same time, sometimes we can macros cases where the PICC they get one and they migrate into the pulmonary circulation, they can be easily retrieved through the vascular access. This is the pulmonary PICC catheter, which is caught with a snare, and it is taken out as a foreign body, and now it has been completely. So the vascular foreign bodies can be retrieved through minimally access procedures through the intervention radiological techniques. Coming to the sclerotherapy, which is a simple treatment for the various vascular malformations and lymphovenous malformations, like this, for example, this is an aneurysmal cyst which is involving the acetabulum. Otherwise, surgical option would be quite morbid. In such cases, we just under CT scan guidance puncture the lesion and put sclerosant inside. That takes care of the lesion. Over a period of time, it gets calcified. Another patient of a 2-year-old patient who presented with dyspnea and dyspeic sclerotherapy, you can see that there was a which was completely treated with just percutaneous sclerotherapy, and the lesion has almost completely resolved. One more patient, for example, of an orbital lymphangioma, you can see he presented like this to us, and on MRI there was an retroorbital lymphovenous malformation, which we usually treat with a minimally invasive access. We do sclerotherapy for them, and usually you can see that the lymphovenous malformation has got completely resolved, and this is how patient presented. He went into the corneal surgery afterwards. I will end my presentation with this last kind of treatment procedure that we do for patients of retinoblastoma. I am audible?
So you are audible?
Yeah. So retinoblastoma patients, they are unfortunate children who usually land up losing one eye, and sometimes then it is a hereditary the retinoblastoma, they land up losing both the eyes. So these children are unfortunately, they undergo various thermotherapies, cryotherapies, laser therapies, systemic chemotherapy, and external beam radiotherapy. But all these therapies have their own complications, like being genetically predisposed, they are more sensitive to develop secondary cancers because of radiotherapy. Chemotherapy has got its own side effects. So ultimately, they will end up with enucleation, because we need to save the life of the child, and we sacrifice the eyes of the child for that. So in such cases, especially when the child is a female child, the family turns away, and the compliance to the treatment is very poor when we talk of enucleation. So, and then when they come across, come back, the lesion is already advanced, and the mortality in these children is very high. So in our setting, we for the intraocular retinoblastomas, we access the vascularity of the retinoblastoma. We through the carotid artery, we go into the ophthalmic artery, we do an ophthalmic angiogram, and through the ophthalmic artery, we give chemotherapy to the patient so that the lesion gets completely resolved. This is a 4-month child with retinoblastoma. You can see on the B scan, with two sessions of we call it a super selective ophthalmic artery chemo infusion. The lesion has been completely resolved. Another patient with retinoblastoma on fundoscopy, after three sessions it has been completely resolved. So you can see one more patient with group B retinoblastoma. On B scan there is a significant mass which after two session has got completely resolved. So with this treatment we have treated almost 83 patients with 153 sessions, and we had complete response in 22 eyes. We downstaged them to consolidation in 10, and there was recurrence in 2. So overall, most important is that the compliance to the treatment was very good, and they didn't, the abandonment came down from 16% to 2.6%. So overall, in the patients, we could 70% of the patient we could save the globe for these unfortunate children, and whatever vision is there, that can also be saved. So at the same time, we know the limitations. Not every child can be treated with this. This child had bilateral retinoblastoma. We tried him with three sessions, but because the tumor optic radiation. So we know that there are limitations. Not everything can be treated with interventional radiology, but with with the tumor board sitting with multidisciplinary team, if we offer these treatments to the appropriate children, we can definitely save their eyes and vision. At the end, I would like to acknowledge the support that has been given for this particular activity by the administration from Tata Memorial Hospital, Wadia Hospital, the faculty from Wadia Hospital, our senior faculty, Dr. Girish Varavadekar, Dr. Bhavesh Popat, and the IR team of Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Suresh Kulkarni, for this wonderful talk and your excellent illustrations. Thanks, a big thanks to you from the on behalf of the Wadia Hospital Pediatric Surgery team. And with this, we come to the end of the day 3 of the CME. It was a great support from everybody. I express my heartfelt gratitude to all the participants who, despite the technical glitches, were with us, and we look forward to seeing you again tomorrow at 8 a.m. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The recording has stopped.